Yeah, I wear a cardigan now, so what? Welcome to Freebooters. Before we kick off, I just want to let you know that we've got a Discord, and it's fun. We play lots of games there, and we even live stream with a few of you folks. Actually, we're broadcasting kind of a bit from the Discord right now, but it's like a recording room in the Discord, and that's also not very interesting, so sorry about that. Hi, Drew, how are you doing?
Doing all right. Yeah, I really love being on the Discord. It's fun people, they're nice people. Yeah, we played a bunch of games together. Ghosty sent a lovely message about how nice it is to have socialization with people, and that was quite touching. Yeah, lovely.
I mean, to be honest, it was worth setting up the Discord room just to hear Ghosty's beautiful French accent.
Oh my god, it's amazing. It is amazing. It's
absolutely. I'm sorry, Ghosty. I know you're going to watch this. Like, you shouldn't feel self-conscious about it. It's beautiful. And
right,
like,
it is beautiful. And we can understand you. And that's what more can you ask for? If I could trade accents with you, I'd do it in a blink of an eye.
Yeah. And also later on in the show, just to finish us off, we're gonna do a tier list of Linux distributions. It's shameless, I know. and we're gonna just make trouble for ourselves, aren't we? Really, we're gonna, you know. So feel free to enjoy the flame wars below.
Thing is, I remember like 10, 15, 20 years ago, people used to get very defensive about their distros. I remember listening to it was called the Tux Radar podcast, but it was the people who wrote Linux Format. Which is one of those podcasts I still listen. I listen to the 10, 15 year old episodes. Like, I still listen to them because I just find them. I like their vibe. But yeah, they'd criticized they'd left Mepis, a distro called Mepis. They left this off like a list of like the best distros ever or something, and they got like literal angry mail, like postal fucking mail about how could you. And Mepis, I've barely heard of. You know, no offense to anybody. Does it still exist? But yeah, no, they were so angry.
My suspicion, but this is literally just going on like what's typical, is that it's been forked into something else, or
probably
like,
and I think it was just a Debian or Ubuntu based things, or maybe it flicked around between, but I think that's changed now. I think people are now, if you take the piss out of somebody's distro, like, you know, I use Arch, and you know, everybody uses Arch as an asshole, and somebody will go, oh, yeah, everybody uses Arch as an asshole, and I'll be like, yeah, I know. You know, like, I don't think it bothers us anymore.
It can't bother you, because, like, Arch kind of, I don't know, I would say Arch almost has won the distro wars, if there is such a thing, right?
I think we're kind of spoiling our tier list here, but I think Arch and Debian, it'll be no surprise to the two sort of use cases for Linux, Arch and Debian, have you covered?
Yeah. Like, I mean, basically, especially if you're like a non-corporate user. What was I going to say? With Arch. Yeah, Arch kind of won the distro wars, because not only it is just seen as one of the, what I don't want to say like one of the default distributions, but it's like one of the main distributions. But also, like, it is being used by Steam for SteamOS, which I don't know. Like, I would say is arguably the most, at least in recent years, the most successful commercial deployment of Linux not on the server.
Putting Android aside, because I think Android counts in that regard. Android isn't really Linux in the sense that we mean it when we talk about it. Absolutely, I agree. Yeah.
And it's it's a non-corporate distribution, but at the same time, Steam picked it up. They picked it up in a way that was really good, like taking the strong points of free and open source software and then running with them, supporting the distribution, all of that kind of stuff, and you know, they made it immutable, so they've got, you know, like a very up to date sort of repository, or like, you know, back end basically.
Well, making it immutable basically nullifies all of Arch's weaknesses.
Yes.
You know, the fact that it is unstable and, it, you know, you can break the system and that kind of thing, making it immutable just like, yeah, fixes that immediately. Obviously, necessarily want that on a desktop PC. I think it'd be interesting, but for what is essentially an appliance. That's the perfect solution.
Absolutely.
It's interesting. So, I think it's interesting that, because Debian in particular and other distributions followed, like, they worked so hard to get away from those text-based installers to like a graphical installer where you just click things. you know, and they eventually got there. They got to the point where they had very slick graphical installers, and then Arch comes along with this literally typing in commands, and the people who worked for decades on those things must be like, oh, for fuck's sake.
Yeah, although I've installed Arch a few times from the command line, and it's an educational experience, like, even if you're not
really
a big Arch person.
It really is.
Because you learn step by step the components that make up an operating system. There's stuff that you don't think of. Like, I was trying to, I was mucking around with config files today in ISWM, and just for a couple of hours. But like, I'd only sort of done some the very, very, yeah, very basics of actually setting up that desktop. It takes a while, but there's so many like little bits and pieces, like network managers and that, like blue light filters and like the VPN, the browser. Then you've got the, like the GTK theming, and then you've got the QT theme. Like, there's so many little bits and pieces that, yeah, like if you're running an out of the box distribution, that's great. It does all of the little stuff for you. And even like, I run XFCE, the amount of stuff that sort of basically automates or like does in a really easy way that would be difficult otherwise is phenomenal. Like, even things like I use a Mac keyboard now. So setting a different keyboard layout that's still English UK, piece of cake on XFCE, piece of cake on all the major DEs. But editing a text file, like for a non-standard keyboard.
If that was me, because I'm using a WM, a Hyperland. I'd have to use, was it Locale CTL? And I certainly wouldn't know the command off the top of my head. So I'd be, I mean, it's simple. When you do it, it's simple. It's a single thing that you type in, but I would have to Google what to type in.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of Googling. And the help files are long, you know, like they're very good. Yeah. They're very well written. Yeah. But they're just they're quite long. So you've got
to. Yeah, if you're not interested in how something works, you just want the answer to your very specific question, which is a tiny piece of this huge project. Like, man pages are amazing resources, but they're not good at that. They're not good at just giving you, you know, the simple answer that you need.
Yeah, I mean, I control F, and I got most, you know, all the way there on that. But also but I stuck it out with the man pages because. You never know, like ISWM, believe it or not, had a release this year. Like, it's still being maintained, and I'll be honest,
I love ISWM.
It's great. I don't know what they've changed, because it seems to be the same that it was like 20 years ago, but that's what, you know, that's what I was looking for.
It was Wayland support.
No way, they're not doing Wayland. Is that a joke? Are you pissing?
That was a joke.
I mean, I'm surprised that XFCE is looking at starting their journey on to Wayland support. Because I thought I would have to give up. I thought I was going to have to give up my beloved XFCE.
I mean, it is XFCE, so if they're beginning it now, it's probably going to be completed in like 2053 or something.
That's perfect. That will, you know, like
gives you time to adjust.
Gives me some time to adjust.
Speaking of desktops, the one that always amazes me is Enlightenment. Oh, because it's one. I remember, like, back in the day, back in the very like, for me, it was late 90s, early 2000s when I was first playing around with Linux. And of course, like, you hear about Enlightenment, you look at it, oh, well, that looks amazing. You give it a try. It was a bit of a mess back then. I think it's recently been anyway. So you try Enlightenment, you'd go, that's kind of impressive, but I'd never want to use it. And then you forget about it for like 5 years, and then somebody will mention, oh yeah, no, I use Enlightenment. Yeah, I've always used Enlightenment. It's great. I love it. And then you look at it now and it's changed so much. But it's one of those that you don't often hear people who use it, but the people who use it, they fucking love it.
Oh, they do.
Like,
they
are
do.
Committed to it.
I remember every time I've done now we're going back quite a bit now, but every time I've done a video on like any like Enlightenment-based distro, which is always, they've always been fine, right? Like, I've never given them what I would think of as like a bad review or about, you know, anything like that. But there's always people telling me that I'm not getting it. I'm not like understanding the benefits.
Yeah.
And I try and I do. I promise I try and listen, and I promise it's not me being, you know, like a tech bro or indignant or anything like that. I mean, I obviously don't get it, but the people that do, they get it and they love it. Like, you know, but I sort of...
Like, power to them. Like,
yeah.
Yeah, you know, absolute power. No, there's certain communities that are like that. I think like tiling window managers, you know, if you're sort of a Linux, not, you know, not just, you know, your grandma using a little bit, like if you're somebody who's sort of like a bit of a, What's the right word for this? Like, not just a hobbyist. I mean, we are hobbyists.
Like a, like more of a casual,
an enthusiast, enthusiast of any sort. Yeah, and you don't use a tiling window manager. Like all the people who do, will be like, you know, why you should be using a tiling window manager. Like, and if you're making a conscious decision not to use them, then it's because you don't get them. Like you don't understand them. I think the same is true of Vim as well, as a text editor. Like if you don't use Vim, like you need to fucking use Vim until you get it.
Well, I'm still in Vim. Know. I'm still learning how to exit Vim. But I mean, I've used tiling window managers before. I've used i3. I've used Rat Poison. So I've used hardcore tiling window managers, and I like them, but I don't stick to them. And now my setup now. Which actually is a point that I've got on my notes, because I took some advice that you offered up. Usually when I set up my XFCE setup, I'll have a whole bunch of quick launch items in the bottom left hand corner, and it'll be like, you know, the usual stuff: browser, file manager, text editor. I've got a clean, you know, a script that just like empties the trash and does a few other like basic maintenance files, all that kind of stuff. And I think you advise, like, I don't know if it was advice or you were just telling me how you
did things. We just had a conversation about how we do stuff.
And I thought, okay, what I'm going to do, I'm going to get rid of all those quick launch icons and I'm going to just attach them to shortcut keys. And I've been doing that and I like that.
Makes sense to me. Yeah, because you very quickly, I think you matched keys to function, like, you know, F for file managers or whatever, but... Yeah, they're arbitrary for me, but you very quickly just get the muscle memory down. Like, I want a web browser. Bump.
So I got Control Alt W for web, Control Alt T for terminal, which I think is kind of default in, default for most window managers. I've got what have I got? I've got Control Shift S for screenshot. No, Control Alt S for screenshot. Control Alt A for application finder. And what have I got? I've got like I'm trying to think now, because when we were doing Deus Ex last night, I'd done a bunch of remapping keys on that. So I'm like, you know, turning off all
Control Alt F, that's microfibrillar muscle.
Yeah. So, and my God, see, the muscle memory has already kicked in.
Oh, control... yeah, you can't think of what they are. You have to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's something I kind of recommend. I kind of like it, but also I can now get my XFCE4 shortcut key file and just stick that in the backups folder, and then next time I reinstall, because every time I do reinstall Debian, it's a new compave. I don't bother updating, because a fresh start from time to time is I think it's good for a computer.
That's another place where Arch shines. That's not really an issue on Arch.
You don't have to.
It's rolling, really. It's simply just because it's rolling. I do like a rolling distro now. I use a tiling window manager. Mm-hmm. I don't really. This comes up with Anjum when we're talking, because sometimes I look at GNOME or I look at KDE, and I envy the simple life. But with the tiling window manager, it's not really the tiling I use it for. It's the, it's really the way workspaces work. Mm. I generally, 99% of the time, I just have one thing full screen on each workspace. So mod key and the number keys get me to specific. So mod one takes me to my terminals. Two is my web browser. Three is my file manager. Four is my email, and then on the other screen, Discord and another web browser, one and two.
Hold on, I like that we could see you flicking through that as you were doing it.
Yeah, I've actually got you on three with my file managers at the moment, which is breaking what I said. But yeah, so it's that I use it for. Honestly, that is the main thing. I do think the tiling. Like, if I open a second window, it just taking up half the screen with the other window by default, I think that is sensible. But that's not why I use it, really. It's the workspace organization is really why I use a tiler. And then I don't need... Because everything in my, you know, very muscle memory, my web browser is mod 2, I can get to it, you know, immediately. I don't need a taskbar. There's no need for a taskbar anymore. I don't need the title bars because I'm not dragging windows around from place to place. So it's that really, rather than the tiling as such.
See, I really like a taskbar because it gives me just a little bit of first. One thing I do find it quite useful, actually having the date on the screen. I date my file names quite religiously. And you know, paperwork and all that kind of stuff, sign and date, etc.
Okay, I'm going to interrupt very briefly. Why have it there all the time when you only want to see it now and then? So I press mod P and a little pop-up comes up that tells me my time and the time for the friends that I need to coordinate things with, which is US East Coast, US West Coast and Australia currently.
Did you do that yourself? As in, like, is it?
Yeah. It's just a little bash script that does a notify send. Yeah, and it's just, so it's pop up and it tells me the time. To me, that makes more sense than having the time there all the time when you look at it, you know, three times a day. Sorry.
Do you do date as well?
Yeah, time and date. Yeah.
I'm tempted to ask if I could borrow that bash script or something because that could be kind of, because the thing is, so I've got a Mac keyboard now. And the thing about a Mac keyboard, and this isn't it's strange having a Mac keyboard on Linux because
hold it up and show it off for people who don't know what you mean
so
by that.
These are scissor switches, and it's a very, very nice thing to type on. I originally switched to it because my mechanical one was having some problems, which I've since fixed. And but for some reason, I've just decided, and so that's Cherry Reds on the 65% mechanical keyboard. This is a full keyboard, but it's still quite small. It's long, but the keypad, which is...
I think it is actually a full keyboard, isn't it? Because it's got the F keys as well. Yeah, it's a full keyboard. Yeah.
It's got the F keys. However, I have to do function and these keys along the top.
There's probably a way to change that back to default F keys, I would think.
Well,
probably watching will probably know that. That would be a useful bit of...
Well, I mentioned this on one of the Deus Ex playthroughs, which, by the way, go and check them out because we talk a lot of shit on there that's nothing to do with Deus Ex as well. Like, it's a little bit like this, but we're just playing a game.
Also, if we're plugging things, go watch our Expanse talk abouty show. It's only on PeerTube. It's on Hamish's at thepolarbear.co.uk, video.thepolarbear.co.uk. I'm really sort of proud of those. I think they're really good. And even if you haven't watched the show, it's mainly us just talking shit.
Yeah, or like trying to make sense of science.
that was a fun one, yeah.
Yeah, I don't... Yeah, it's... by the way, I've watched the episode, so we're good to do another one of those. But
cool.
Yeah, so anyway, where I derailed. Oh, yeah, so keyboard, right. So yeah. So I did a bit of research on this, with the Deus Ex one. Someone in the comments section actually gave me some suggestions. And I don't think, at least in XFCE, you can have basically a function lock, or, you know, like how caps lock works with function or something to that effect.
I wonder if those keys that you need, so what would be the F keys? They presumably just send a key code. So you could probably do it with just Xmod map. You could probably just Xmod map them to the F keys and then the other things with the function keys if you wanted that. In fact, you can map them to anything you like with the function key.
That's
probably doable. There might just be a keyboard layout that is Mac but with F keys as F keys.
It could be, but if it is, it's not obvious
right.
One it is, like it's possible that it could be named peculiarly or not obviously, but I think because Mac OS does it in the OS, they don't do it then on the hardware, and because there doesn't seem to be a function obvious to me in XFCE, then it seems that I'm at the moment maybe stuck on FN.
Even if there's not a thing for it, I'm sure you can do it with Xmod map.
Probably, but also I think Ghosty was telling me that a lot of BIOSes, I hope it's Ghosty or someone in the Discord was telling me that there's a lot of BIOSes that will have something like that. So I haven't actually, as of yet, looked there, but there's options. However, I do. Yeah. I don't even know if I want to do that, because, like, I like having the volume buttons on the keyboard, right? Like, on my headphones, I do have volume here.
Well, you could put that on function or any arbitrary key as well.
Yeah, but function, then it will start clashing with games or something like that.
I don't think
so. So it'd be like, I'd be quick save, bang. Ooh, I've muted myself. You know, that, or something. You know,
because your quick save would now be the F5, which would be just the key. And the volume up down would be function. The key, you just flip them, basically.
I suppose, but I. But then I've also got the eject button, which obviously, well, I don't know if it's obvious. I don't have a CD drive, so I've remapped that to the task manager. I don't know why.
Be careful not to press that key; it will eject you if you don't have one. It's flying out the roof.
It's the eject. Yeah, I don't know, because you'd think, oh, if it's the task manager, it'd be Control Alt and then. Well, it's not going to be T, is it? It's not going to be D, because that's Discord. What would it be? It'd be like, it can't be C, that's cleanup.
you do start
I don't know.
Okay.
I've run out of letters, haven't I?
Yeah, that's when you need an extra modifier key.
Need an extra modifier key, yeah. But I don't know. Like the default, having like weird miscellaneous keys as the default allows me to map them to. Like, I think I did at one point have one map to, like, the App Finder or something. So there's other things. Like it's... Oh, and also, it's got F13, F14, F15, F16, F17, F18, and F19.
Is it really?
Yeah.
That's cool. So you can just map anything plus above 12. No program is going to use. So you just map them to anything you like.
Yeah. So, yeah, life on a Mac keyboard's kind of peculiar, because it does some things like a Windows keyboard. It does some things like a Mac keyboard. Really, I just like the scissor switches on it, because
it's just nice.
Your fingers just float along the keyboard. Like, you can type.
While we're on it, I'm on a Happy Hacking, which I got it a while back. It's a ridiculously expensive keyboard, but it's got top ray switches, which are capacitive. And it just. So I've used an IBM Model M, so I know what I'm talking about. I've got an IBM Model M. It's on the shelf there. You can just press it. The buckling spring keys are amazing. But this is my favorite keyboard I've ever used. The top ray switched Happy Hacking is, and the layout is literally designed for Unix. So it's just perfect, absolutely perfect.
But I think you should come clean about something about your keyboard preferences.
Go on.
You don't like arrow keys on your keyboard.
No, I don't. So in a terminal, you don't need arrow keys, right? You can use essentially the by default in all terminals, I think, the Emacs key binding. So Alt F is like the same as pressing Tab or right arrow. Alt A or E. Sorry, not Alt. Control F. Control Alt. Control A, Control E, and Control N and P for down and up. You don't need arrows. What the fuck do you need arrows for? Where else do you need arrows?
Gaming and typing with, you know, like word processing or games.
Don't use a word processor. They're pointless.
Well, I just mean text editing, right? Like
Vim. Problem solved. Also, the Emacs bindings are probably working text editors. Probably, maybe. If it's in a terminal. If it's a text editor outside of a terminal, go back to Windows. What are you doing?
To be honest, if I was to go back to another mechanical keyboard that's not that one, like, I'm not going to buy a new mechanical keyboard just for small preferences. But I think I probably would go 75% rather than 65%. Because...
Yeah, you do like the arrow keys. I mean, I've got arrow keys on a modifier. Like, I've got a function key and then arrow keys.
Is it a lock modifier or a hold modifier?
No, just hold you downy. Yeah, on this keyboard.
Okay.
This is a discovery the other day, because I'm so used to what are called the Emacs key bindings now. Yeah, control E to go to the end, control A to go to the beginning, control W deletes a word. And all that stuff, because I use a terminal quite a lot. I discovered the other day you can set GTK to use those key bindings instead of the other ones. So in anything that uses GTK, which is Firefox, Discord, most graphical applications really use GTK, right? I can now use the Emacs key bindings, which is really nice.
Okay. Well, there we go. I use Home and End and Page Up and Page Down a lot when I'm type in and edit it. I know there's Vim bindings, Emacs bindings, bindings of Isaacs.
In terminal stuff, I mean, Vim, GG, and G. Yeah, I mean, I get it. I did used to. I never really used arrow keys. I didn't. I never liked arrow keys because they're away from your. You're taking your hands away and putting them over here. But home and end, I did use a fair bit. But yeah, Control A and Control E takes care of that.
I mean, it's. I appreciate the small size of the 65%, but it doesn't like the extra bit of space for arrows and home and end and stuff. I have another keyboard. Here. Now this isn't a proper, like, I got, this is just a,
ooh.
Well, I called, this is a mini keyboard, right? Like it does, it doesn't have like a lot of the technical terms that like mechanical keyboards have. It's scissor switches also. It doesn't it's not. The build quality is not up there with this Mac keyboard.
No.
The Mac keyboard is like, I mean, it's metal. A metal keyboard feels very luxurious.
Metal, but still light.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, one of my requirements, one of the reasons why the Model M didn't really work for me is I do actually put my keyboard on my, like, I'm reclining right now with my legs up on my desk and my keyboard is on my legs. And yeah, I'm in that position a lot of the time. And if I do that with a Model M, it would cut off the blood supply of my legs and I would get quite gangrene.
Well, but this isn't a 65% or 70%. Yeah, that's just it's just a mini USB mini keyboard. It has all the F keys. It's about the same physical size, but it has the F keys all along the top. It's a UK standard because a lot of mechanical keyboards come with a US standard layout.
Yeah.
It's got arrow keys, albeit small, but they're there.
That's probably, in fact, like a laptop keyboard. Package it up and plug it in, which, why not?
Yeah, it's basically a laptop keyboard. Like it functions and feels, you know, very much the same. It's good quality, you know, it's good enough quality. But I
think people are too finicky about mechanical keyboards are obviously more pleasant to type on. If you spend a lot of time on your computer, you should probably get a mechanical keyboard. But if you get like a £15 knockoff Amazon one with knockoff switches, perfectly fine. Like people, it's one of those things where people try and convince you, oh, you don't, you need this, you don't, just get whatever keyboard works for you. Same with mice, forget, like I've shown you, haven't I, like, current, because I'm using a trackball. I should probably talk about the trackball, actually, it's really nice. I'm using a trackball, but when we play Left 4 Dead, I'm not quite proficient on the trackball enough yet, so I'm using this tiny little mouse that came with an Acer Aspire 1. And I'm playing Left 4 Dead with that, and I'm no better or worse than I was with my genuinely £250 Logitech one that charges off the mouse mat, you know. It makes no fucking difference.
I don't know if I've shown my mouse on Freebooters. I think I've won one of the gaming videos.
Oh, you've got a vertical mouse, haven't you? Yeah.
I got a vertical mouse, or as someone on Mastodon referred to it, the cursed mouse. So it's kind of hard to see. Now this is like less than £20. So it's a very standard mouse. I decided to go with the wired because I'm trying to minimize my use of batteries. Like batteries, they're like really bad for the environment, and also they don't last as long. You got to charge them up. If I was a pro gamer, maybe I'd start. You know, I'd talk about latency or stuff. But but
that's the thing with the pro. You know, the pro mouse. You know, when they're going about the gaming mice with no angle snapping and this speed sensor. Remember, if you're a pro CS player, that probably matters. If you're anybody else, if you're me, if you're you, doesn't fucking matter. No.
This is designed. The reason why it looks like this, your hand sort of fits on it sideways, basically, like this, right?
So you're not twisting your wrist to use it, is the idea, right?
Exactly. It's just, now, for most people, you might not, if you don't use it very often, then you're not going to, it's not going to be too much of a difference, right? But if you're on a mouse for a long period of time, having it so that your hand, this is much more of a natural position than this. Now, it might seem very small and inconsequential in small doses, but, you know, over time, it's just a more, you know, it's a little bit more in line with your joints.
Especially as we get on.
Oh, God, yes.
Not spring chickens anymore. We don't just mend. I can fucking put my back out just standing up.
Yeah, I can't operate tired anymore. When I was young, I could just do 2 days in a row. Like, I just like, you know what? I'm not going to sleep tonight.
Yeah.
Now it's like, if I am going down, I'm fucking going down.
In the Discord we were talking about this. Like, I used to be able to do 2-3 days, no problem at all. Could even push to 4 without sleep. I don't need a ton of sleep, or I don't need sleep that badly. But then I can still do 2 or 3, but I get there's certain points where I just get really sleepy. Then I'll get my second wind, and you know, but even the second wind is less reliable than it used to be.
Totally. Yeah, it's. I remember before I stopped drinking, one of the things that sort of knocked it over the threshold was the hangovers. Like, because the thing is,
you don't get hangovers when you're young. When you're 18, you can drink. You drink yourself inside out, and you wake up, and like, you might feel a bit groggy, but you don't get a hangover. Yeah.
I remember I was in a nightclub at 2 a.m. but the night before an exam, and I just went in. I did the exam. It was fine. It's like I could not do that now.
I definitely did some of my A levels pissed.
Mm. See, that's embarrassing for me because I got shit grades and I wasn't pissed.
I got a D in physics, and in pure maths I got an N, which. Literally, so there's U is like you failed, and then does it go to E? A, B, C, D, yeah, E. Yeah. And now A star, of course. But yeah, N.
Not for A levels.
Maybe not for A. Is that just GCSEs, isn't
think
it?
That's just, well, unless it. Oh, no, they've got a number system now.
They've got to fuck off. Stop changing it. But anyway, I got an N, which literally is a near miss.
What's like a near miss?
You nearly passed.
Wow.
And I went into that because I actually stopped going to the classes because they got to calculus and I didn't understand a fucking word of the classes. So I just stopped going to my maths classes, but you still have to turn up to the exam. And I just sat there. There was like 2 questions that I could just about answer. And for the rest of the 90 minutes or whatever, I was literally just playing on my Game Boy. I was playing Tetris. I didn't have a fucking clue. Don't know how I got in, honestly.
I kept failing psychology and I just couldn't get it. And it's like, because in the classes, I thought, okay, this makes sense. You know, we did like the Harvard Prison Study, all the basics, Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you know, the Freudian stuff. I suppose this is a little bit more of the history of psychology or whatever, right?
Mm.
But it just didn't translate into the grades.
Not because I was always good at exams. Test, like I love a test, and up until A level, like I shined in exams. I didn't do homework, I didn't do any court, didn't do any revision. But I'm just good at quizzes, so like I enjoyed enjoyed exams. Whereas some people just A, they just don't work with how their brain works, and B, like they make them very nervous and stuff like that. Right? Were you not an exam person, or was it just you didn't
no, get exams? Okay, all right. So, there's a bit of a sad story behind this, I'm afraid. But basically, when I was in primary school, I tried really hard on exams and got really good grades, and I got in trouble because my grades were too high, which obviously is incredibly fucked up. And it went to school in a very fucked up school, to be honest. But yeah, my school very much wanted the wealthier kids or the kids from wealthier families to get the higher grades because I live in a town where there is a very big private school industry. So when plebs like me start doing too well, it starts upturning apple carts and so I got top grades in my SATs level 2. So that's exams you take when you're at 11 years old. But because I got bollocked so hard for it, And like, you know, you'd sort of like tell the adults in your life, but like, they don't fucking believe you because you're like,
yeah,
of course they're not going to believe. So they, you know, they, so it kind of, ever since then, my enthusiasm for it kind of dwindled and dwindled and dwindled. And it's like, whenever I came up against a bit of resistance, my brain would just check out. I'd be like,
I was very similar in middle school. So my middle school, sourced its pupils from 2 posh villages and my very working class village. And they just put you in sets based on your perceived ability. And I, because I was from the working class village, there was four sets. Basically, set one is the, you know, the brainiest kids, and set four is the, you know. They put me in set three for pretty much everything, I think. And then it came to, yeah, we had, they stopped calling it the 11 plus, but hadn't started calling it SAT, so I don't think it had a name, but the tests you do at age 11. And I got higher marks in the test than anybody in set one in everything apart from English, I think. And Mr. Marks, the maths teacher, he actually took me out of class, took me down to like the sort of park area in the school, sat me on a bench, and he was like, look, like, we can't keep you in set three, obviously. You've outscored everybody in set one, but you just don't pay attention and you don't do your homework. Like, what are we supposed to do with you? he was asking me, like, what do you want to do? And I was like, it's up to you. Like, I'm not going to start doing my homework, but, you know, if you have to put me in set one, put me in set one, but I'm not going to do my homework, but maybe put me in set two. I don't know.
Oh, my God. Yeah, okay. So, you know that meme? Okay, so I'm going to carry on the traditions of describing memes in actual text. Do you know that one? I think it's like one of those reality, the sales programs, and he goes, the best I can do, you know, like the best I can do is, and you're like, the best I can do is good grades. You can't promise homework.
I'll do all right in your tests because I'll fucking love exams, but yeah, I'm not going to do the homework. Why would I?
Yeah. I'm kind of curious because like I was not getting marked particularly well on my coursework in IT. In fact, I was getting, you know, like E's and F's in a lot of cases.
Yeah.
But I got 100% on the exam. And to this day, it baffles me why no one even accused me of cheating. Like, every single question on that GC. And I know I got 100% because it was fucking easy.
My year was the first year that they introduced coursework with the split between the exam and coursework grades, but they let you decide the split. So I said, like, I'm not going to do the coursework, 100% exams, put it all on the exams kind of thing, everything on black.
Everything on black.
Yeah.
God, I fucking hate school. Do you know the thing, okay, not to get too much into this, but I know there's a lot of people in our audience that probably feel the same way or similar, right? Is that the thing that I really despise about the way that they go about school is, you know, like, I come in, you know, I wear glasses, I'm a bookie kid, I'm good with computers. The immediate assumption, always good at, he's academically minded.
Yeah, for sure, yeah.
And they put the two and two together. And it's like, and I get a bit pissed off because I've got friends that were like, who I was smoking around the bike sheds with, right? And they were fucking up and skipping school and shit like that. And they got loaded onto an apprenticeship where they're now making fucking mints. You know, you put the kids that don't show up on apprenticeships. It's like, how? Well, that's not fair. And then you go to university.
You just needed to be not so well spoken and have worse posture.
You would have been
basically. That's what it comes down to, right?
Yeah. And it's like, and then I go and do my university course because I'm a good boy or whatever, right? Like, I can knock out a good enough in most cases.
Yeah.
But then it's like, well, once you've got your degree, and everyone always says, oh, look, once you've got your degree, you can go on and do anything you like. They don't fucking tell you that once you've got your degree, you're basically like, you're ineligible for like a whole bunch of apprentice stuff or you know, like, because it's like, you've got a degree. What? You can't get a job? You got a degree?
I went for a job. I didn't have a degree at this point, but like, I went for a job just packing in a biscuit factory. Mm. And they said I was overqualified. Would I like to work in the office? And I was like, no, I want to work in the biscuit factory. And they got angry at me and threw me out of the interview. But I was going to say, yeah, there was two times in my school career where, so the first time, it was in middle school, and I was called to the head, no, they arranged a meeting with my mum and dad, and they wanted to see all three of us in the headmaster's office, right? Mm-hmm. And we went in, didn't know what it was about. They didn't tell us what it was about. And we all sat down, they chatted with my parents for a while, chatted with me, asking questions. And then he just went, it was Mr. Davies, was the headmaster. He just went, I'm going to be honest with you. We couldn't explain Drew's behavior and we wondered whether he was being abused at home. So, my parents were like, oh my fucking God. He was like, I'm so like, clearly he's not, you're lovely. But we just can't explain why he doesn't care about anything. And then the same in high school, I had a detention. with my chemistry teacher, Mr. Nandy, and he insisted on driving me home, which I thought was a bit weird. And then he was like, do you mind if I come in? And it was the same thing. He was scouting out to see whether... And he was like, oh my God, you're lovely. I'm so sorry. I thought Drew was being a...
Oh, man. It's, yeah, God. What's... Yeah. Oh, I'll tell you, I was thinking that this friend of mine got in trouble, right? Because this is a weird old school thing, right? To get in trouble. No kid will ever get, well, kids get in trouble for this kind of thing in a different way, right? But my friend got caught printing out porn on the school printer.
and they, one kid,
right?
Yeah.
They called the police.
No.
And he had to have a sit down and have this really awkward conversation.
What would the charge be?
Oh, I don't think there was a charge. I think it was I think it was just like, because, you know, you're I can't even remember. We might have been under 16 or something.
It's just like scare you straight kind of thing.
Kind of, yeah. But it's like compared to like nowadays, the technology, they've got VR porn and all this kind of stuff.
that's something. This comes up when I watch, because I watch a lot of podcasts with like people, you know, my age and, you know, Gen Xers basically, and just they marvel at like it's the access to porn that we had to, and that, yeah, this was talked about on a podcast I watched recently. You had to hope you found like a rained on dirty fucking porno mag in the woods. That's how we got porn, or like next to like a truck stop, maybe you'd find a porno mag in the bushes. That was it. That was your access to porn. That was it. Other than that, it was the K's catalog and the underwear section.
Yeah, or Daily Sport. I mean,
even when I was 11, that wasn't titillating to me.
Isn't it not? I don't know. Like, you know, not to get too much into the details of it, but like, they had great tits and great articles. I'm sorry.
I've never been a fan of huge tits. Is the problem? And it was always in the papers. Also, I love how much it shocks. Like, Americans find it shocking that we have a newspaper. I don't know. Does the Sun still do it?
No, they got rid of Page Three a while back.
They got rid of, okay, but until relatively recently, yeah. The daily newspaper, it's news, and on Page Three, just a woman with a tits out. Like,
yeah. Yeah. I mean, yeah, I think it's kind of weird that, like, tits in general are as, like, taboo as they are.
Yes, yeah.
They're kind of fun, like...
Is it because they're covered? Because I assume, there are cultures in the world where, you know, they just... don't wear tops, right? They walk around with the tits out, and presumably they cannot possibly be titillating in not a pun. In that culture, the breasts cannot be titillating, right? So it's because we cover them, presumably. I don't know, you're the psychologist.
The failed psychologist. I think it's the culture of the culture, because like legs are titillating and legs aren't like
that's tabby. Fair. Yeah, no, that's true. That's true. You know, I love a nice neck or a nice upper arm. Beautiful. Mm.
Yeah, and it's like arses as well. It's like, you know, men and women and all the other genders, who doesn't like a nice arse? You don't actually have to, like, see the arse to enjoy the arse.
No, that's true. Yeah, in fact, often the covered arse is more, you know.
Yeah, it's the allure, it's the mystery. Yeah, and also, I think in a lot of cases, with tits, you know, like, it's like, they don't always have to be flying around for them to be great, you know? Like, also, just to be body inclusive, it's not just big tits for me. I like all shapes and sizes. It's just, you know. So there's that. Okay.
I'm going to talk about trackball now.
Okay, yeah, from tits to balls.
So back in the day, I had a Logitech Sum trackball. And I loved it. And so I was like, I like trackballs. So I moved on to the big finger trackballs. Elecom blade and the Elecom, the other one. And they were okay. It's a really nice big heavy ball, so it's just like tactile. The tactility is really lovely of just rolling it around. But I didn't like it as much as the thumb track ball, and it took me a long time to realize that. So I went back to a mouse for a while, but then I missed trackball. So I've got a thumb. It's a new Lia, which is a Chinese brand. People were recommending this over the the Logitechs. It's new Lia. It's only wireless because it was cheaper. The wireless one was cheaper than the wired one. So yeah, I've got that. It can do the dongle thing with the RF, or it can do Bluetooth, and it can connect to two separate Bluetooth devices separately with a little switch, which is nice. And I can't remember the last time I charged it, which is cool. And I absolutely love it. Yeah, it's a lovely thing.
So I got a question. Does the thumb, like, one of the reasons I've always avoided thumb trackballs is because when I think about moving my thumb, it always feels like there's a lot of pressure on the tendons on this.
Yeah, no, it's not. Yeah, you just sort of, because it's a very small ball, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So you just sort of you just, like, it's very tiny movements. You're just sort of tickling it.
Oh, okay. Almost like a nipple. Just like
like a nipple, yeah, but even less pressure. Like you don't even, because it's, you know, it's trackball, so it's very free. So there's no, you know, it's just your tiny little flick. Yeah,
I've got this one, which I used for years and years.
Size. Yeah,
And I like, the reason I like this is because you can use it in with your hand in all kinds of positions.
Yeah, yeah.
So you don't
yeah.
get the RSI. It's also
In terms of how you hold it, this is very much like a traditional mouse. It does actually come with a little plate that lets you rotate it to be more vertical. But yeah, it's very mouse shaped. Just a little bigger. Put your whole hand on it.
There's a relatively recent... Do you watch BigClive.com on YouTube?
No, not heard of that.
You've not heard of BigClive.com?
I don't know the big ones.
I think he's from, like, Manchester or somewhere vaguely up north. I think his day job is pyrotechnics or something like that. Mm. But he does a YouTube channel where he just takes apart various electronic items and just shows you what's inside. And he does the schematic and all that kind of stuff. It's really interesting. I can guarantee there are going to be, like, several people in our Discord that follow Big
Clive. That sounds like something I would enjoy as a relaxing...
yeah, absolutely. Like, he is... Yeah. I think he's on the larger side of YouTube. Not on the largest. He's large for you. I think he's kept
to his roots. I've actually gone a bit up in my I think I've run out of tiny stuff to watch, and I'm going a little bit up in that tier list thing.
Oh, actually, I was watching a Morrowind tier list of the factions today. It was a YouTube recommendation, and I thought, oh, okay, this is just like one of many YouTube channels about Morrowind. There's quite a lot of them out there. YouTube's worked out that I'm a big Morrowind guy, and it started recommending them to me. This guy had like 50 followers, and it was a really well made video.
I see tons of the stuff I watch, like, it's 200, 300 followers, and it's, they've been making videos for like 10 years, and they're excellent. Like the girl I showed you, she stopped making videos now, I think, but can't remember what the video was, but it was that woman who, like, she never stops talking. There's no pauses in her talking. It was amazing. Yeah, but she's very, like, very personable, very charismatic, and yeah, just like, you know, a handful of viewers. I don't get what, you know, who gets famous and who doesn't, or maybe not famous. I don't want people to get famous, but, you know, who gets successful. Or
I think it's, I see, I'm not sure about this myself. I think to a degree, I think it's a lottery of, like, what gets picked up at the right time in front of the right people and all that kind of thing. Like, it's what gets jumbled through the machine, and part of it's chance, but, like, if you do some content, is almost destined to go viral, like the Mr. Beast. You go bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger.
At some point,
you're going to catch some eye. I think that with super produced stuff,
I'd say that's a separate category. The people who are leaning into it and who are chasing, you know, chasing the numbers. That's one category. But the people, you know, there's a whole broad middle category of people who they're just doing their thing. But it's very much like it's almost identical to somebody else doing the same thing with, you know, thousands of times more viewers. It's just luck.
Have you ever, do you know Jacksepticeye? He's a Irish YouTuber, and he's gone from, obviously, well, I was gonna say he's gone from a very small channel to a very large channel, obviously. He was doing a small amount. He had a small channel, but then another big YouTuber called Markiplier, who I'm going to also assume you don't necessarily know.
I do know him.
Markiplier. And he did something like top 10 undiscovered YouTubers or something to that effect. And Jacksepticeye was one of those. That in and of himself gave him enough momentum to carry on.
When people have had a bit of success, and they help out the people who, you know, they recognize that their path, you know, they got a bit lucky there, or they had, you know, some resources, and they use their position to help bring other people up. I like that a lot. Yeah. I respect that.
I mean, to be honest, you know, I know this is going to sound like typical burnout talk from us two, but so much of success is just like luck, just showing up on the right day. You know, there are other factors, of course. Like if you're a dedicated lazy bones, then you're probably gonna, you know, you'd need extra luck to bridge that gap. And if you're out there,
talent and hard work certainly come into it. Like,
yeah, but you can be talented and you can work your ass off and you can still like just get nowhere, and it could be no fault of your own. I have seen really good small YouTube channels. Some people of all ages and all kind of thing. I remember like some science channel. There was a period about 10 years ago where I was getting recommended a lot of like really small science YouTube channels by people that put a lot of work into it. Some of them were like university professors and things like that, and they just never clicked in. Yeah. And there's no obvious reason why. They weren't particularly boring. They weren't particularly different from the ones that do succeed. It's...
I mean, I know that the stuff that I like a lot is so much calmer than what seems to be popular, and I think that's part of it. Like if you're just calm and you talk calmly and reasonably, that's not what people are after. Like the raucous, like over energetic, like American TV style of things seems to be the most popular. It comes into it.
But to be honest, there are
certainly like sedate ones that do well.
Oh, like Review of the Week. That's the... You'll recognize him when you see him. He's the one that did the review on two different types of spring water.
I was thinking of it when we were talking about keyboards and how people, you know, how enthusiasts can get about keyboards and stuff. That video I was talking about, he just talks about like, what if there was a subreddit for like water? And he just does a little sketch, and it is the perfect. I'll link it to you, and you can put it in the description because everybody should watch it. Fucking funny.
We need to keep track of all these links. Is there? I could put.
I'm gonna send it to you now, so I don't forget.
Well, there's a little window has a little chat down the side there that you can.
Yeah, I'll put it in there.
And that way, at least it's on the screen. So
if we forget,
yeah. So that's quite good.
Another thing I wanted to mention. So I mentioned a while back that I've moved from Qt browser back to Firefox for the most part. Sorry, I'm not good at talking and doing something.
At some point, we'll do a tier list of browsers because I've actually been playing around.
I can be up there. So I'm back on Firefox, and you know, one of the reasons I went to Qt browser was for, you know, keyboard centric key bindings, Vim key bindings. But of course, Firefox has key bindings. You can use Firefox, you know, with the keyboard. So I just went and learned the Firefox key bindings, and now I'm using Firefox in a very keyboardy way. And you know, I just sort of want to say like that's an option.
Oh, so you didn't need to change anything or much or install any
add-ons? No, I thought I would learn the default key bindings, and yeah, so it's Control L. I think just focuses the address bar. That's handy. Control W closes a tab, Control T, new tab, and that's pretty much it. That's all I need, really.
And let's not forget, top tip for folks at home, because it took me far too long to work this one out, Control Shift and Tab opens the last tab you closed.
Undo close tab. Yeah, that's super useful.
That is super, super, and it works multiple times. You can just go Control Shift, T, 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 T. Not that
one,
you want
one
to.
One fucking annoyance I have with, I don't know when they started doing this, right? But if you know when you start typing the address in Firefox, and then you see the address you want, so you hit tab, right? If you hit tab again, rather than going down to the next address, as it should do, it highlights this little dot, dot, dot menu thing, which I don't know the purpose of. What's that? Remove from history and learn more. Okay, so you have to tab. You get down to the next one, you have to tab twice now. All for a menu that I'd never fucking want to use. Just another one of the stupid Firefox things they've
added. Does Alt and D also, or does that go to your search bar? Or
Alt D. What's that supposed to do?
I can't remember.
That also goes to the bar. Yeah, didn't know that. Yeah. That's handy.
I think if you've got it so that you've got the address bar and the search bar as two different bars, I think Alt D takes you to the search bar, but...
Oh, okay.
I could be wrong.
Another little Google tip, because another thing I did in Qt browser is set up, I don't know what to call them, like quick links. So I open the address bar, I type G space, and then what I'm searching for, and that searches on Google. I space searches on IMDb, W space searches on Wikipedia, you know, so you don't have to open the website, you don't have to go to the search bar. And you can do that in Firefox. Firefox also has the thing where you can add search engines, but you can ignore that. If you just bookmark the search with %S, where the search term would be, and then you add a, what does it call it exactly? So you open the bookmark manager. And yeah, when you've made your whatever your search thing is, oh, you just name, it's just called name. So you just give it a name. Is it name? Mm-hmm. No, sorry, it's not name, it's keyword. Add a keyword. So for Google, I put the Google search URL with %S where the search is, keyword G, and then I can just use, you know, without having to use that silly interface, I can just use, yeah, G, I for IMDb, you can just add all those. Does that make sense? I feel like, yeah. I went that sideways, but yeah.
Yeah.
The thing doesn't have to have a add to search engine thing in order for you to use it like that as a search engine.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, what's your default search engine in the address bar?
Google.
Okay, yeah. Because I know DuckDuckGo does something similar. It does.
Yeah, I would like to change search engine at this point. Google isn't very good anymore, and the AI slop that they put at top of search results is really making me angry. Yeah. I'm reluctant to use DuckDuckGo because I think there are a lot of hype. The privacy and security stuff is not that big a deal. They're still owned by, you know, for-profit company, so if they get successful, they're going to go down the same evil path that Google went down. And fundamentally, it's just fucking Bing. So, you know, why don't I just use Bing? If there was a proper... For me to switch, it's either got to be much better than Google, and then I don't care if it's corporate, because Google's corporate, or not owned by a for-profit corporation.
I can't remember if Mojiki is a for-profit. I'm assuming it is.
It is, yeah.
And it's also... It's got a long way to go. I appreciate what they're doing, but it's...
Well, actually, what preferable in the middle tier would be a for-profit corporation, but they're not in advertising. That would make a...
Oh, actually, well, there is, if you can believe this, a paid-for search engine.
A pay-for search engine?
You can actually... Yeah.
See, I never thought I'd pay for email, but then Postio came along. I don't think I would pay for a search engine, but maybe if something as good as Postio came along.
It's too much. It's too much to pay for a search engine.
if it's the same as Postio, where it's like, what is it, a euro a month?
It's like five something a month.
Yeah, no, I'm not paying that much. Yeah.
That's the thing. I was like, do you know what? Right, I don't know how much it costs to operate a search engine. If it was like £1 a year, I know that's very low, but they can't be making, they're not making £1 a year advertising off of me, are they?
Well, exactly, yeah, if we're ad blocking everything. Well, they're still selling your data is the thing. Even if they're not making money advertising at you, they're still, you know, collating it all together and selling it to you. But yeah, I just want to head off there, because, you know, stupid liberals going to say, well, you know, if you don't want an advertising-based site, then you've got to pay for it. No, we've got to restructure society so that you don't need fucking profits to run a fucking website. So,
well, that would be a search engine as a public service.
Exactly, yeah.
Take
your liberalism and fuck off.
Yeah, because the thing is, at this point, you know, the internet...
I'm not going to disguise my anger at liberals.
It's fine, I totally get it. I mean, you know, we can talk about the vote bloom no matter who people in the next day or hour. It's ramping up, we should do another one. And let's be honest, top Trump material is going around now.
Yeah.
You know, Okay. Actually, now that you mentioned the AI slop, I don't know what I've got a note here, right? That's basic. Okay, so basically, so I'm trying to, like, I want one sort of mainstream social network to keep my foot in the door of social networks, right? Because I'm not really on Twitter. Well, I'm not on Twitter anymore. Delete my Twitter. Instagram never really sort of worked for me. Facebook is too, like, it's your real name. Like, if I'm going to talk to someone on Facebook, I'm probably just going to talk to them in real life. Like, it would just be, or like, yeah, you know, ring them up on the phone or talk to them on, you know, like, Facebook is just too real on the internet, if that makes sense. What other ones are there? I talked about, well, TikTok is, I don't know if that's really what you think of as a social network, but sort of. But
which one, sorry?
TikTok.
Oh, right, yeah.
It's a candidate, but it's very mobile specific, so it's not really kind of for me. And I do sometimes think it does towards the younger side, but I think maybe that's changing these days or anything like that. So Blue Sky, I did have a Blue Sky account. I deleted that. I didn't even remember that I deleted it. But I must at one point have realized that it's just like, it's full of just the annoying people on Twitter that aren't quite Nazis yet, you know, like, same thing with Threads, and also Facebook. Why would, you know, like, you know, I mean, Threads just feels like a worse version of Facebook, and Facebook isn't great. Like, Facebook is just,
yeah.
You know, why didn't they
feel like the old people one?
Yeah. Facebook's the old people one. I don't even know what Threads is for, like, millennials that have lost the plot or something.
That should be the tagline. For millennials that have lost the plot.
So I'm a bit social media homeless. I don't know, is Tumblr still a thing? I think sometimes I check in on Tumblr from time to time, but it's like, that seems a little bit like derelict these days.
Yeah.
But one thing that seems to draw me in from time to time is Reddit.
And yet you accuse others of using Reddit words.
I did accuse you. You did use a Reddit word.
There's nothing wrong with sophomoric. It's the appropriate word.
I mean, I'm not saying it wasn't a proper word. I'm saying it's a Reddit word.
I don't even know what I mean. No, sorry, carry on.
The word you used to replace it was wank, and that's a much better word.
I think wanky would have been better.
Wanky, yeah. Wanky. Piss poor. You also use piss poor.
Piss poor.
Yeah, you know, all perfectly valid alternatives. But I was on... I'm not on Am I the Asshole, but Am I the Asshole is one of those subreddits that just gets recommended, like, blanketly, right?
Yeah.
And there was a story that someone had written about how they were at their brother's... They were visiting their brother's wife. They were sitting in the living room, and they overheard their brother's wife talking about an affair that she's having with someone from work. And this guy's brother went home, told him, and now, allegedly, everyone's mad at this guy for breaking up their marriage, right? Am I the asshole for telling my brother he's being cheated on, right?
And to be fair, that is a difficult one. If you're friends with both members of a couple and one of them is cheating, what to do in that situation, I think, is a crippling dilemma.
But if it's your brother, presumably your allegiance would be to your brother over his wife, right?
Hmm.
Anyway, the thing is, right, this feels a little bit trite, right? Because for a start, who's going to be talking about the affair they're having with the guy in the next... Anyway, basically, long story short, this was an AI post, right?
Okay.
And there were a few clues that gave... Now, here's the thing, right? I scrolled down, because the thing about the Am I the Asshole subreddit, it's not the story that you give a shit about, it's the comments, it's the replies.
Yes. Yeah.
You want to find out if the person's the asshole. And I had to scroll down about 70% of the way down the replies of this rather popular post before someone pointed out that it was AI rage bait.
Interesting.
And then I thought, that's interesting, because I thought it was weird that she would just be having a conversation on the phone about an affair. And also, divulging this information. It's like, oh, I know we shouldn't be having this affair. Oh, it's so secret. And his brother's in the other room. And
stuff like that, sometimes I can put down to, like, they're simplifying the story in order to get it. You know, you don't want to get into too many, you know. But I get it.
But also, yeah, that's, I mean, don't get me wrong, that's what I could have clicked.
What's the purpose of an AI posting? Because on YouTube, when you see the AI, what you think to be AI comments, that's because they're trying to make that account not look suspicious, right? It's not just hyping up, you know, the things they've been paid to hype up. It's making it look, it blends in. What's the purpose of an AI posting on? Is it for training it or?
My suspicion is that it's just someone that wants a bit of attention, went to ChatGPT and said, tell me a scandalous story, and they posted it.
Oh, God, do we need to invent a new Munchausen syndrome? Munchausen syndrome by proxy by AI.
I mean, basically, because it's like... the thing is, the person who suggested that it was AI rage bait, they just said... They said it was a very basic comment. It was like, I can't believe people are falling for this AI rage bait. At that point, because we're people and we tend to take people at their word by default, it doesn't likely occur. But once they put that idea in my head, I went up a Reddit and it's like, yeah, obviously it's AI. It's AI because there are little tricks that you can tell. So AI works in a particular, like it has a certain theme of, it has a certain style guide. It has certain, so for example, it will religiously use the Oxford comma. You can see why, because that, like in the logic of a computer brain, it's like, yeah, the Oxford comma makes more sense because not having it is a lot more human, I guess, in a, that's a bad way of saying it, but it also, the post,
isn't that simply just that they aim to write well, you know, and correct use of an Oxford comma
and consistently, like and all that kind of thing. So it would make sense that an AI, when it's trying to fake it, would use the Oxford comma, but also it was perfect grammar, right? Like it was there wasn't a spelling mistake. Every,
can you not tell, in a such situation, would you not just tell the AI to write a bit shitty though?
Well, if you're the kind of person that just is trying to get Reddit clout without the work, you're probably not that bright, right? But it does get me thinking, like, it's a bit like dead internet theory, is that, like, we don't know the times that it successfully fooled us, you know?
I think it's one of those things where like when they do studies into lying, and you know, some people think they're good at detecting lies and some people think they're bad at detecting lies, and they do studies and it turns out essentially everybody's bad at detecting lies. It's very hard to detect a lie, and if you think you're good at detecting lies, you're probably wrong. There's the odd exception, but broadly speaking, people aren't good at detecting lies. I think we like to think we would be able to spot AI. But like you say, we've probably been fooled by it.
Yeah, it wasn't
numerous times at this point.
Yeah, it wasn't a particularly difficult spot. It was just, if someone had told me,
like you say, we go into things. This is why marketing works so well in advertising, because we go into things in good faith. If we think this is another human being talking to us, then we assume good faith, and that extends to advertising, which is a real fucking problem. And that's why corporations like to present themselves as if they're an individual talking to you. They're talking to you as a friend. Because the assumption is, why would somebody be lying about this, which is a reasonable assumption.
Advertising is by its very nature bad faith corporate propaganda, literally, you know?
Yeah. Not propaganda even for anything good, anyway.
I suppose in theory, like, you know, some advertising could be done in good faith, but not the stuff you see on the internet,
Historic, you know, advertising, you know, just recommending, or, you know, the very early advertising was just like, I make good irons, but you know, come and look at my irons. that's fine. You know, I want an iron. Yeah, you say you make good irons, I go check them out. But it's obviously become something quite different now.
Yeah, actually, I mean, the thing is, right? Like, I'm sort of at this point in my life, right? I'm sort of thinking about like the next chapter, like what I want, you know, what sort of career path I want going forward, right? I'm planning it out. And one of the possible thoughts is like something freelance, something start my own business, that kind of thing. But the thing is, you look at the marketplace and it's like, so what am I going to do here, right? Like, am I going to come up with an idea that's not been thought of before, or fix a problem that people, you know, like... You know, am I going to fulfill a need? Am I going to help people with this product? Or is my business just going to be cutting into someone else's market? Basically, because you walk up and down the high street, and you think, look, not necessarily the high street nowadays, because that's a bit, but you know, you go on to Amazon, eBay, any of the shopping sites, it's all covered. I can buy anything that I want certainly at a price I can't beat as a newcomer into a market. And it just kind of gets me thinking. It's the constant growth of capitalism, isn't it? Is the idea of like, well, it doesn't matter if the market's saturated, make more and make money off it. And it's like, now we wonder why the ocean is
kind as possible. To be as kind as possible to capitalism, what's supposed to happen is you are supposed to spot somebody doing something imperfectly, do it better, and outcompete them on those terms. You know, either cheaper or higher quality, essentially. And then people go to you, and then that's good for everybody, because now we are getting cheaper or better things. But we've kind of hit the point where things can't be improved in most cases on those grounds. So yeah, we are late stage capitalism, and we need to switch to a different system.
Yeah, in fact, I think actually, funnily enough, on Reddit there was a post about how like clothes that we buy nowadays, like first hand clothes, they don't last anymore. Like the fabric is just not as good quality.
So now we're getting if you take those blinkers off, and the critique of capitalism is essentially you just get increased monopolization. And once something's monopolized, you can reduce the quality and increase the price.
Exactly.
You get the opposite of what capitalism is supposed to give you. Also, quick note, Stalin's kind of to blame for advertising, in that when he was in charge in the USSR, he obviously had his purges and his clampdowns, and a lot of propagandists moved from the Soviet Union to America and became advertising people. Well, and that's kind of what led to the modernization, the revolution. They took what they learned in Soviet propaganda and applied that to capitalism, basically. And that's when, like, the emotions and the talking to you as a person, as a friend, as a appealing to your ideas of what you think you should be, rather than just saying this is a good iron. That's when that all started.
Do you know? Actually, I was thinking about that the other day, because you look at a lot of Soviet era propaganda, and there's a lot of manliness, isn't there? We are the men. We have the spanners. Yeah. We make the aeroplanes.
Yeah. Well, there is some gender, like also very very kind of like capable, physically capable women as well, like women working in factories, women in the army and stuff. That too,
There's a lot of like manliness, and then it's like you can see where that's transferred over into the advertising. Yes. Think about it, right? And this is definitely American-centric. Sometimes we, import a little bit of this. It's like, it is bizarre to me how, and I'm not a manly man, right? Look at me. I'm wearing a fucking cardigan. I've got my hair up in a fucking bun, right? Like, I'm not.
Well, you may be snot.
I've got a flowery shirt on. Like, trust me, right? I'm almost trying not to be. But the thing is, it's like, how insane is it that, like, your choice of fucking beer, like, determines a level of masculinity? You drive a pickup truck, and so it makes
you hear people say, oh, that's a hairdresser's car, like, you know, it's to demasculate. Who fucking cares?
It's insane. Like,
everybody opt out. Bring up gender now, bring up the application, just opt out of gender.
I think, honestly, I reckon that, like, in 100 or so years time, like, gender will be a faded concept, and we'll just
the thing that we laugh at, like caste. Yeah. Although, some places still have caste, but
like in terms of the identity, it's like colors the thing is as well, it's like, it's the inane shit, like it's the type of car that you drive,
on the more damaging end, like being empathic. Yeah. Showing that you care for somebody.
Oh my god! Do you remember,
what a girl.
Seatbelts. Seatbelts.
Yeah.
Don't be a fucking girl. Wear, I know it's not so much the case now, but I think that's an example of how fucking dumb it is. Is that, like, now I'm going to die like a man? over.
Needlessly endanger your life like a man.
It
hooks together, and it fundamentally comes back to capacity for violence. Like, society needs to keep that capacity for violence in men so that we can do wars.
Yeah, see, this is why I think sports is kind of not great. I know I'm gonna get so much fucking pushback from that, but it's like,
briefly before we go completely off it, the Soviet propaganda that I really like is the ones that just say, like, read books, reading's good. that's my kind of propaganda.
Why couldn't we have made reading manly?
Go to the theater.
It's like, god, they've really done us out of some really good things. I say us, like, I don't give a fuck, but that's one of the advantages of being a specky kid at school, actually, is that no one expects you to be good at sport. It's fine.
Well, I had the opposite, because my appearance, more so when I was younger, probably. Like, I look like I've got this, I've got the natural scowl, I've got, I'm physically, whatever. So people assumed, in fact, I've had so many people in my life who've talked to me and then have said to me, like, I was always scared of you or intimidated to you. I thought you were like a rough person, like a ruffian. Yeah, I thought, you know, I thought you'd beat me up or something if I talked to you. I'm like, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
I'm lovely. Please come talk to me.
Yeah, I used to live with a guy who was he was about, I don't know, 6'4" or something, and like really big and northern. And he was autistic and had social difficulties. So, like, we got on really, really well. And we kind of became what was known as the Timon and Pumbaa from of our university.
Oh, it's adorable.
Because I like helped him with the social stuff, and and with him, I could walk anywhere in the city. Yes, and no one's going to lay a fucking finger on me. So it's like, you know, and he looks so, like he'd never been in a fight in his life, I don't think, but like he just looked. He looked the part. Yeah. He's a strong man now.
That's cool.
He probably could fight, but he's not. He's not.
He doesn't want
he's
to.
He's not a fighter.
Yeah.
It's just like, yeah. I don't know if I don't. I don't know, because like, I have definitely had my head kicked in at times where like I couldn't even bring up my fist to defend myself. I know how to fight in theory, because believe it or not, I've actually won.
That's the nerdiest thing you've ever said.
Well, I mean, in theory, like, because I did a lot of karate at school, did some martial arts tournaments and stuff like that, and I won one final against a farmer.
Well, the thing, the difference in an actual fight is just you've got to be angry, you've got to want to hurt the person, and I can't imagine you in virtually any situation wanting to physically hurt another human being.
No, that's the thing. I couldn't, and it's really got me not in trouble. Like, I don't go looking for fights and then whatever. But yeah, no, I don't have. And also, just to be fair, actually, I'm bigging myself up a little bit, but I have very long arms and legs, which just gives you an advantage. It just gives you an unfair advantage. It's just a biological advantage. So I wasn't exceptionally good. I was mediocre with long arms and long legs. Yeah. But it was fun. I enjoyed it. But I never thought of it as fight. It's a sport. Like,
absolutely.
Going back to that point about sport being a bit like confront, like the best things that we've done as a society are not like from competition, but from working together, right? And you look at all these big, like, you know, the sci-fi stories about, you know, a lot of them are like people coming together and working. Like, I know that a lot of the time stories have like, oh, there's this big enemy of the unknown, so all human beings have to put aside their differences, come together and build, which in and of itself is kind of like, otherizing, you know, because you're whatever. But like, you know, like the internet, that was, I mean, okay, I guess history of networks is like has a link to the military and war and stuff like that. But like the World Wide Web, you know, that's like more of a academic pursuit, really, with Tim Berners-Lee and everything. And the
even,
best
even
part
the internet, the role of DARPA and ARPA is overstated. There was two internets at the time, and they got connected up. One of them was British and wasn't a military thing, and one was DARPANET, which very quickly became an academic thing anyway. Like it was DARPA that had the idea of it, you know, a network that's could survive a nuclear attack or whatever. But it was universities connecting together that, you know, made it a reality, really.
Yeah.
So this is going back to we had a conversation, didn't we, a few weeks ago, just talking about cooperation and competition and violence and their roles, and we broadly agreed, but then you said, like, and sport is bad, and I was kind of sport's kind of okay, because it's, you know, it's cornered off and it's an outlet for these impulses that we have, you know, we're violent beings and we need this outlet. But you turn me around on it as just being sort of a celebration of competition, when what we really need is celebrations of cooperation.
It's like the Olympics sells itself as this coming together of nations, despite the political undertones.
That works on me. The idea of nations coming together in peace and just, you know, having fun together. Yeah, I like that as an idea, but... Yeah.
But it's not. It's like this last Olympics, it was China versus America.
Yeah, yeah.
And I felt like that's not really unity. It's seeing who can kick each other's ass in a admittedly more friendly way than others. But at the end of the day, like, couldn't we just have all the nations come together and like build a Lego model? That'd be pretty cool.
Because we do, it's certainly, we find competition, like you and I, we play Left 4 Dead, right? And we're not competing against each other, but when that scoreboard comes up, you know, you've killed this many zombies, I've killed that many. It feels good when you've done well.
Yeah.
So so in small ways, like we're not like completely anti-competition as, you know, blanket.
No.
But there is a difference. There's a very stark difference between that and the way, the way the athletes would sort of talk about it at the Olympics. And, you know, it's beating, it's doing over, you know, it's destroying, you know,
yeah,
another person. That I'm rambling. I'm falling
into
a hole.
No, you're right. I think the difference with us and Left 4 Dead is that we know you're a better player than I am, right? You've put more hours in, not just to Left 4 Dead, but like video games probably as a whole, like, you know, and all that kind of stuff. So it just wouldn't make sense for me to be a better player than you anyway.
But you and Hamish, like me and Danny are sort of vying with each other, and you and Hamish kind of vying with each other. But like, yeah, and you know, Hamish will be happy when he's like, I didn't come last. You know, I didn't come last. Like,
I would still say that Hamish is better than me. But the thing is like, in many ways, yeah. If I don't come last, like in many ways, I'm competing with myself.
I think that's probably the difference. Yeah, yeah, I did well, and especially I did well for the team. Like, I wasn't holding us back. I pulled my weight, kind of thing. Yeah,
totally. So, that's sort of pretty much it. I forgot what point we were originally on. I've got more notes if you want to move on to the next.
Yeah, no, go for it. Yeah.
This has been on there for a while. Clip. Sorry,
you got a bulldog clip?
Yeah,
I love a bulldog clip.
I've got a box of them.
Bulldog clip. They're wonderful. I don't know why I've always loved them since I was a kid.
They are so useful.
Fascinating.
You can clip these onto the back of your desk and you can tidy your wires with them.
Yeah.
They come in all. Look at that. That's tiny one. Tiny one.
It's adorable.
Yeah. So I've got a whole bunch of them. Sorry?
No, it's just no. Oh, yeah. It's a weak track.
But yeah, I've got even some of these wires back here. They're all sort of lined up. Bulldog clips, fantastic. Yeah, so yeah, basically this is all
Freebooters review of bulldog clips. 10 out of 10.
10 out of 10. I mean, this is just like a bunch of paper. And
yeah,
it's
yeah,
just,
yeah.
I made a notepad out of it. And also, yep.
I used to make sketchbooks when I was in art school, like that.
Yeah, it's
they just look cool, and you can hang them up.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you can hang them up as well. Also, what I do if I want to hang, sometimes like I've got a few photos up or like wooden prints on board, I'll just like stick a little bulldog clip on and then just hang it onto a little tack on the wall.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they're very good for holding if you don't want to put a hole in them. Yeah, there's just a million and one uses for them, and it's just good to have a stack of them around. They last forever. Paper clips, they always get lost or stuck up your ass or something, but
fiddle with them and bend them into the shape of a flamingo.
And also, hang on a minute, I can't remember if this is true or not. Ghosty, can you help us out? Do French people call paper clips like mini trombones or something?
Oh yeah, no, you mentioned that the other day. Yeah, paper clip is a got the shape of a trombone, right?
Yeah. So I can't remember if that was us having a joke.
The paper clips, we call them the little trombone.
That's
exactly what Ghosty sounds like. You should come and hear him.
Come and hear him. It's great. Roll up. Oh, we don't make him.
Sorry. I know we're going to your notes, but both Ghosty and Wing have mentioned this woman called Cadence, who is very cool. Her website. Did you visit it? Yeah. Did you mouse over all the links? And they've all got like different effects and shit.
Yeah.
Did you look at the Game Boy camera photos? They're fucking cool. I love a Game Boy camera.
I haven't seen the Game Boy. Is it actually Game Boy camera phones?
Yep. Have a quick look at that. So cadence.net. But yeah, Cadence, and there's an article on their website about all the ways Discord is shit, and they're all 100% correct. Like they're bang on. But I really want to get this person into Discord with us to hang out with us.
It's Cadence.mo.
I think Ghosty said they watched this. So, Cadence, if you're listening, come join us.
Do we? I think we follow. Do we follow each other on? I'm pretty sure we follow each other on Mastodon.
No. I don't think they have a Freddy thing. I was looking for a Freddy link. Oh. I don't think they have a Freddy thing, which is surprising, right?
That is surprising. No Freddy link.
You seem cool. We want more cool people.
Awesome, yeah. Oh, the God Gemini.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
They like email. That's
but yeah, both Ghosty and Wing were talking you up.
Mm-hmm.
So. Was that a separate thing? Was it her Ghosty was talking to when he was talking about how nice the social interaction was? I can't. Maybe not.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Oh wow, there's a why you shouldn't use Discord.
It's very detailed and very like it's bang on. It is all very very accurate.
Yeah, I mean, we've probably covered this before, but
we know Discord is shit. It's just where people are.
It's where people are, but I think if I was to choose, I think IRC is still, I still I was think just it's the say, top dog.
If I got to choose and everybody else had to come to where I was, it would be IRC and then just break out to a Jitsi room if we wanted a voice chat.
Yeah, or maybe give Mumble a go if it could be made easier.
Mumble's always a bit of a hassle and you need a server.
But it's the quality's great and the latency's fantastic.
Yeah, that's true.
It feels a little bit like, it almost feels radio-esque in a way, you know?
It does.
But the idea, IRC is great. Like, I think that federated chats aren't worth the hassle or the security.
No, I don't think so either, yeah.
It's
plain text, it's a simple protocol. There's a million clients, you can make your own fucking client in an afternoon if you wanted to, right? It's such a simple protocol. Yeah, and most of the time we want text. I don't particularly, like, you can drag an image into Discord and that's nice. But a link works just as well, really.
You can drag an image in on some IRC clients. And to be honest,
they will show the images, yeah.
If IRC was a bit more well-known, the doing it on the client's end makes all the sense in the world to me.
Yeah.
That's why, actually, I'm using, weird tangent, but I think it works. I'm using a different front end for Mastodon. Not to poo-poo the current Mastodon layout, but I'm looking around for something that's just a bit lighter, just trying to like slim down the system resources a little bit, and I was looking for a multi-column layout that was just a little bit lighter than Mastodon, and it's called Phanpy Social. So it's a web front end. You log in like you do with all the other front ends. I usually, if I want an alternative front end, I usually go with Pinafore Social. And that's really good. And that's very lightweight, but it's single column. So this is Phanpy. It's very, very customizable. It does most of the same stuff that Mastodon does in the multi-column format. Lots of customizing. It's just a bit lighter. And it customizes and there is one thing about it that is kind of interesting, which is if you click on a person's profile, there's a little chart at the bottom that says that is like, it's like a bar, and it has three colors of it to determine the percentage of original posts they make, the percentage of replies they make, and the percentage of boosts they make.
That's cool.
So, and that's in the past 6 days.
I did say when you mentioned Phanpy, I did say I'd give it a try so we could talk about it, and I completely forgot, but I will give it a try after this. I've actually, since going back to Mass, because I had my own instance for a while, and that was running...
GoTo Social?
No. The Fork of Pleroma. Anyway, a Fork of Pleroma. I can't remember. A coma. and I got used to the single column, and when I went back to Mastodon, I'm on mass.to now. I'm sticking with the single column. I've come around to the single column, and also the single column one doesn't crash every fucking half hour, which is nice.
Does your multi-column crash?
Because I leave a browser window open. Mm-hmm. And I don't keep tabs open. When I'm done with a tab, I close it. I'm not, you know, people always talk about I've got 50 tabs. I never have more than like 3 tabs open. I close ones I'm not looking at. But I always have like a final tab to, you know, come to rest on. And I wanted that to be Mastodon, but yeah, it would just hang my browser every half an hour. So I couldn't use it like that, but single column's fine. Also, this is meta, but in this, where did I put that video before? Because I thought it was this chat. But it's not.
It was this chat. What I think I did is I think I closed the chat and opened it, and it cleaned it.
Okay, that's all right then. Okay. I was very confused.
I'll do a check. I'll do some research now.
Also, yes, it's cadence.mo, sorry, not cadence.net.
Yeah, cadence.mo.
For anybody who's just listening in words.
How do I get rid of the chat? Is it something like I can close it there, yeah. And then if I open it up again. Oh no, wait a minute.
So where the fuck did that video go? I swear it was in that.
Did you did I put it in?
Oh, I did. I put them both in the voice chat on the... Fuck me. I hate that Discord added chats, text chats, two voice chats. It bugs the shit out of me, but I put it in the normal one, not the secret recording one.
Right, gotcha.
Yeah, so it's a video. I'll put them in here so people can see them. I've also put, yeah, that Angela Collier, who I think is a great YouTuber. She's a science YouTuber, but she's got a great video about AI entitled AI Does Not Exist, But It Will Ruin Everything Anyway.
Yeah, the pollution is seeping into the culture.
So there's that one. That one's worth it. Oh no, that's the other one. Oh, it's Pogsy. Yeah, he's the dude I was talking about in a previous video when I was trying to describe that video. That video is very funny. You should watch that. And that video is very informative. You should watch that. She's good. Angela Collier. She's great.
Awesome. And actually, since we're talking about other clients, we've been playing a little bit around with Visk Desk. Hang on, what's it called?
Vesktop. It's Visk a really desk. Hard name to remember.
Remember, well, the thing is, as well, is that
you think it would be Vescord,
but it's, well, Vescord is like Vescord.dev is like the website, but
right,
Vesktop okay. is the application or something.
Yeah.
If I look into
it,
I go
for a way to stream with sound on Discord, basically, weren't we? On Linux. Yeah.
We were so close, and yeah, but because the C++ library in Debian stable is a little bit out of date, for some reason that just, you know. So we tried the Flatpak, but then we had the problem with the Flatpak, was like the sandbox almost being too good or something. Like,
yeah.
So we'll get there at some point. But
and for me, of course, on Wayland, it all just fucking crashes. You're supposed to be able to in Discord. Stream with Discord on Wayland, but it has never worked for me.
It's, I mean, very broken. I don't know if a week goes by and you don't talk about your desire to ditch Wayland at this point.
Yeah, and yeah. There's no benefit for me. If you've got variable refresh rate or some of the other fancy things that it supports that X doesn't, makes sense. You get a benefit from it, but for me, I get no benefit from it, and it's just worse in some ways.
Yeah. I mean, it seems to give you a lot of ball ache, but I was wondering. One of the reasons
I don't just switch back is like just sort of a reluctant acceptance that it is the future. X is going to, you know, not it's never going to disappear because it's open source, but it's going to become more and more unsupported and less the default. So it's a little bit of acceptance of that. But I mean, you're on X, you're quite happy on X. It's not like, you know, missing out on anything. So.
Very happy on X. And
the BSDs don't have Wayland. They're going to be with X for a while, aren't they?
Yeah. And I know that at some point I'm going to go over to Wayland, but I want it to be pretty solid when I do.
Like a bare minimum would be as good.
Yeah. Right? You know, ideally. I mean, I'm on Debian XFCE, and I know that XFCE have started now the process of getting the ball rolling to get onto Wayland. So... I do you know what? I think I'll move over when XFCE moves over.
That's fair, yeah.
That seems to be, you know, when it's the default on Debian XFCE, that seems like a good time for me. A lot of Debian should definitely have XFCE as the main distribution, because the Debian stable XFCE people, there's a few of us, and we know exactly what we want, and we get exactly, you know.
What's their default? I mean, they don't technically have a default, do they? But what's their de jure default, de facto default?
It's GNOME, but I think they do actually, like, I think the file name of the ISO is Debian default, maybe?
Right, okay.
But I think
GNOME does make sense.
Yeah.
Because it is very, you can't, XFCE you can reconfigure to be completely different, whereas GNOME, you've got to use it, really. You can fiddle with it a little bit, but fundamentally you've got to use it how it's intended to be used, so it's a bit easier to tell people how to do things and stuff.
I guess, I mean, KDE...
And it's more, I think it's probably familiar for people with, you know, coming from any kind of... I mean, it's most similar to a Mac, I think, but, you know, it's a familiar...
Actually, I would say that... Well, I you know, it could be a little bit like mobile too.
I think it's like a
Yeah,
phone too.
like a Mackie mobile. If only Macs make mobiles.
Whereas XFCE is going to be familiar for anybody coming from Windows 95.
Yeah, and anyone like say your standard Debian,
Somebody's just been sticking with Windows 95 until something comes along that tempts them away.
I mean, my last experience with Windows was Windows 8.1.
Like for me, it was using it myself. It was 7 and not far into 7 when I completely switched.
Yeah, no, it's about, I think it was 8.1 when I was dual booting, and then I switched fully. But now I can't even think about, I don't, I, because the thing is, it's like the trouble with Windows and Mac is that they're both like they're online first, and I
I
want
mean,
to.
even before that, even if we're talking about, I mean, what's the high point of Windows, like XP or 7, depending on who you talk to, or 2000, even comparing to those, like, I'm so in love with the way Linux works and the way it does things, and being able to use the terminal and just write bash scripts that do things, and I can just bind them to a key command, and just the freedom to choose my own interface, and just I can't even if Windows were better than it is now, I just it's not what I want.
No, and also like I know I get like disagreement on this, but like Linux to me, like it is the operating system that just works
No, yeah, I
in a way
agree.
that the others don't, right? Like Macs have their place, but the trouble with Macs when I use them for work, I was always coming up against things that you can't do. Not like just Macs won't allow it, like getting sound from the desktop or something like that. Like there are always these weird little edge cases with Mac that's just like, oh, we just don't support that. Oh, we just don't do that. And like sometimes there were workarounds, but it's like everything, if you want to do anything techie with a Mac, there's a hack. You gotta there's or a third party, image file you gotta get in or something like that. And
Often
most,
paid for.
yeah, often paid for, but
But
like
Danny was looking for a per volume, per application volume thing for Mac, and it's just you can get it, but it's a pay for application that you run essentially.
so then it's going to be tied to your what, Apple account or something, and
I don't know.
yeah, I mean most of my work applications were, you can get a lot of open source stuff on, you just download as like a DMG file and install it. You can get KeePass, like KeePass XC. You can get Kaden Live on the Mac now.
Sure,
You
as
know
well.
you can get a, I think Firefox you need to get it as a DMG. In fact, to be honest, I don't even bother with the Apple Store. It's useless to me. I just go straight to the websites, which I
But
don't
yeah,
know
no,
if it.
Ghosty on the Discord, he's so for, I think for gaming, I know he still uses Linux, but for gaming, he's gone back to Windows. And it was that, like, things kept breaking. Windows is the just works thing. But for me, and I accept that fact, like, I don't care. I'm not judging people for what operating system I use. What works for you. But for me, yeah, definitely the other way around. Windows is always the one where I'm like, how the f what's what? Why is this problem suddenly a thing? How do I fix this? And it's always some archaic like solution. Whereas for me, Linux, yeah, I mean, I'm an arch, which is fragile. And yeah, not that I don't have problems, like the Wayland stuff and that, but like if I want to do something, I know how to do it and it works.
Yeah. It's very rare that I come up against problems on Debian, especially if I leave things well enough alone. We had a problem with my fucking, and it was something, basically it was my the kill switch on my VPN was getting irritated by ICE window manager's tendency to hard reset things.
But the when you kill switch on the VPN, it doesn't seem like it's all the time or something, but I don't know what circumstances, but the kill switch on the VPN would make etc.resolve.conf, which is what tells your operating system what DNS service to use, it would make that file immutable. So network manager presumably, but the problem was when you were on the VPN, which is the bit that confuses me, but presumably that means that network manager can't overwrite it. And anyway, yeah. I was going to say, like, I think being on Arch sort of trains you to know where the problem is. Like, I think the role of Arch as like an educational experience can be overstated, but I do think that sort of manual having to select everything and type things in to set things up It does teach you which bits of the system are responsible for which things, and if you have a problem, it's like, oh, that's going to be with, you know, this thing.
Absolutely, sort of... yeah. And because things go wrong so rarely in Debian, I'm a bit of a fish out of water when it does.
Yeah, I mean, you forget, don't you? Like, if you don't have a problem with something for ages, you forget what it is that, you know.
And also in a lot of cases, it's like, because it, also things change. Like, I'm still used to some things pre-System D. I don't have any opposition to System D like others in the community do, but there's System D things that have literally made things easier, but I have to relearn it, which is fine because, you know, it's usually a case of like, if you point me in the direction of the right file, then it's a bit easy, you know, it's a bit easier. And I don't have, well, perhaps maybe the historical knowledge of Linux where I know where to expect a file to be. Like, I know roughly, but like, I don't have the encyclopedic knowledge of, oh, it's a network file that does the DNS.
I was going to say, with regard to, because I was talking about the graphical installers, then Arch comes along and goes back to a text-based installer. But I think the difference there is, okay, so back in the day, in 1999, when I was installing Debian, you have to choose your network card, you know, and back then it was a network card, and you don't know what brand your network card is or what chip it has, but you had to choose, you know, your chipset of your network card, and you had to came a point in the installation, it was like, okay, now type the mode lines for your monitor, which is essentially like, horizontal, like resolution, horizontal refresh, vertical refresh. And if you get those wrong, it could destroy your monitor physically. It could break it. Yeah. And that was the problem with the old text-based installers, is it was complicated questions that you didn't know what they were for, and they could destroy your system, and all that. Whereas Linux has got to a point of maturity where the text-based installer now isn't that experience. It's just making choices with text instead of making choices by clicking on them, really.
Yeah. To me, I like the live distributions because it gives you a quick glimpse as whether or not you can expect your computer to run it.
It does, but it never runs as, you know, because it's running off, you know, a stick, and it's never the same as running it on, you know, on the actual hardware anyway.
No, but you know, if it picks up your graphics card, you know, if it picks up your wireless, you can always do a bit of a dry run before, you know, committing, as it were. Nowadays, like, I'll buy hardware that I know works on Linux anyway, because...
That approach wouldn't work with Arch, because in Arch, you want to install only the drivers for the stuff that you are. I mean, a lot of them are in the kernel anyway, but you want your Arch distro set up to only support the things that you have and do. Like, for example, I don't, if I stick a USB drive in, I don't want it to auto-mount. I want to mount it myself as and when I want to, you know, access the files on it. So I like that it doesn't do anything by default, and because I haven't put anything on, it doesn't do anything. And that's what I personally want.
And that's the default on Debian XFCE as well.
Is it really? That's good.
Because I imagine the people that, you know, maintain that probably feel the same, you know.
Half the time when I plug a USB device in, it's because I want to format it for using it with something else.
Yeah.
And when it mounts, I've got to fucking unmount it before I can go and format it.
Yeah. And also, I hate... Steam is awful for this. Things that just steal focus.
Oh, I know, God,
that, that feels a little bit like an old man yells at cloud thing these days.
No, I'm 100% on board with that. So it's rude.
It is rude. Yeah. I've got a taskbar. I know what windows I've got. You don't.
Well, Steam does it by default. Steam grabs it, and it's not because I can be tired. You know, I launch Steam, and Steam takes a fucking age to launch. Yeah. You know, and I'm typing away in something else, and then it grabs focus, and suddenly I'm not typing anymore. Fucking irritating.
Yeah, that's quite audacious. Like, if it was like, you know, a file manager or a text editor or something just flips up, that's one thing.
Yeah.
But it's like, you know, you do, you know, I do my shortcut key, which is Control Alt and G for games, and then, you know, I don't even know why I've got a shortcut key for it, because it still takes fucking forever. You know, well, not forever.
So long. Like, yeah.
Five seconds, 10 seconds.
And it's two different windows as well. It's one window comes up, and then that window closes, and then different windows up, and they both grab your fucking focus. Luckily, in window management, especially in Tyler, I can set window rules to prevent it from grabbing focus, which is what I've done. But I should, there's probably a way to do that in like XFC and stuff as well, but
what specifically for Steam? I don't know. And Steam is in a different directory than the rest of them. It's in like USR Games or something like, or some. It's in. I don't. Yeah. I'm assuming that there's a good reason for it, but maybe maybe it's messy and maybe it should be just a little bit. I don't know, but because I run the native.
I mean, it's not really. It's one of those applications that's not really, even though it's been ported to Linux, it's not really Linux software. It's Windows software running on Linux.
Well, yeah. But funnily enough, actually talking about the Linux Just Works thing, how many times have we just fired up an old game and it's just worked well in Proton? And then like someone like, you know, Danny, who runs Windows, is like, comes up against issues.
Yeah. I mean, Flat Out 2 with Manise. I wanted to play Flat Out 2 with Manise. She's on Windows.
Mm.
Wouldn't fucking run. You can Google it, you can find out how to make it run, but yeah, on Linux you just press play and it plays, you know.
Yeah, there's a few games where it's generally considered like, so to, you have to install the fan-made patch for it to get it to work.
Yeah.
And I think Vampire the Masquerade, I don't even know if that works on modern systems unless you have the patch. Everyone plays it with the patch. The patch does work on Linux, but it's not essential. You can run just the standard base game on Linux. It's a buggy masterpiece, so you do want, you know, in probably many other ways, but there's so many games
essentially Wine is the most stable Windows API in existence.
Who'd have thought? Like, I remember getting freaking Morrowind and Deus Ex to run at, you know, through Wine, and I was dealing with out of like aspect ratios that weren't, you know, stretch or, you know, and I was like, you know what, I'm grateful that Morrow, even if I have to play on a 4x3 resolution on a 16x9 monitor, that's fine.
When I was dual booting for a long time, and dual booting was but essentially running Linux most of the time and then going to Windows for gaming occasionally. And then I think it was a bit before Steam came to Linux that I made the complete switch. I was like, fuck it, I don't care about gaming that much. I'm just going to go 100% to Linux. And in that, there was a point for a few years where I had like essentially like three games that I could play on Linux. You know, discounting all the open source stuff that always runs, of course. Yeah, I had like three games that ran on Linux. And it was fine. Not ideal, obviously. I'm not saying I want to go back to that. But yeah, but within 5 or 10 years, Valve came along and sorted it all out for us.
Amazing. I kind of do want to go back to that.
It is amazing looking back.
You want to go
back to the limited choice.
Because at the moment, like nowadays, in practice, day-to-day stuff, does it matter if you run Windows, Mac, or Linux when it comes to most things? No. The job gets done. The thing is, I liked it when a game was an event, and it's like, Borderlands 2 is coming to Linux. That's great. And like, I would never have played Borderlands 2 if it wasn't for it coming to Linux, as you know. You know, it made me play games I wouldn't usually play. And
that is nice. I think there's something to be said for having a more limited choice. Of course, like this abundance is amazing, but it is that we've talked about it. We've talked about it many places, including in the Discord. But, you know, when I was little and I had my C64 or my Atari ST, and I got maybe like 2 or 3 games a year, and you milked, firstly, you chose them very carefully, and secondly, you milked every drop of, even if you bounced off it at the start, you were going to persist with that game and milk every drop of fun you could get out of it. And whereas now, like, I'll go, that game looks good, install it, it doesn't immediately grab me, I just uninstall it.
And there were, like, back in the days of computer magazines, when, you know, on the rare occasion I'd have to get a train, I would look in the magazine, you know, in the W.H. Smith or whatever, pick out a magazine to, you know, this is before phones and all that. I'd usually get a Linux magazine, and they would have like a 2-page spread on a game just talking about it. Like, it was a review, but they were just talking about the game in the same way that we might on Freebooters, but in a little bit more of a formal sort of, you know, but like, and they'd have screenshots and it would look so much fun. Yeah. I can't imagine that being a thing now in the same way. I don't know. It just feels like it felt like it was something very shared amongst us.
Yes. Yeah. It was an event, like you said. Yeah. Whereas now it's, I mean, I scroll through, sometimes I'm like, I fancy a new game, and I scroll through Steam. It's like that. It all looks boring. Not interested in that. Not interested. That's another roguelike. How interesting, you know. Whereas, when they were doled out a couple of months, it was like, oh, wouldn't have otherwise been interested in that in a million years, but let's give it a go.
See, that's the thing. Like, I, you know, forgive the Protestant work ethic coming through a little bit, but when things are, you know, free and in abundance, it is so much easier to take them for granted. And
there's something to that. And it's difficult to say. You don't want to say, like, let's go back to, to 3 games a month or whatever, if that. But there's, maybe something can change in terms of how we approach it, or, but I do, something has to change. I meant, this came up. Like, I've got a very weak graphics card now. My GTX 1070 blew up. I've got no money, so I had to buy a very cheap AMD graphics card, and it won't run a lot of games. Mm. And that for some reason, that's nice.
Mm.
Firstly, I'm freed up, because when the AAA games came out and everybody was excited about them, I wasn't really. I still felt some like, oh, maybe I'm missing out. Maybe I should be playing this. It never did fulfill me. And now I can just go, yep, that's not for me. I can concentrate on, the games that I can seek out games that will run well on this computer. And having your choice be restricted a bit is nice for some reason.
It inspires thoughtfulness, I guess. I mean, I don't even know if it is a downgrade. It feels like a downgrade when I got a mini PC. I'm not a hardware person. I'm fine. I'd rather have just... a mini PC. And so I'm in that mindset of, games that I play and buy, they're going to be on the lower end. And I've got to be honest, I haven't missed the high-end games.
No, not at all.
Flat Out 2 is my favorite racing game of all time.
I'm sure there's a point for both of us when, I used to care. I used to want an up-to-date, high-performance system. I enjoyed building it. I enjoyed purchasing the components and then, assembling them. I think I've just done it enough times now that I want the easy life. When this thing finally gives up the ghost, I'm gonna get one of your mini PC things, put it on the desk, it works great, I can play what I can play and I can't play what I can't play. Not fussed.
Yeah. There's a few newer versions of the B-Link out now since when I bought this, and they look really lovely. In terms of the thing that I like the most about them is that they're focusing on making them quiet. The next iteration of these. Is it a small company, B-Link? I mean, they seem to come out quite near the top of search engines.
I think they've risen to prominence in those kind of machines.
Yeah, absolutely, and rightfully so, because it's just a super Linux box. And I mean, you could use it not just you could use it as a server box or all sorts of things.
They're generally AMD CPUs with an APU, right? That's generally what we're talking about here. So they're a decent, never top end, but a decent-ish onboard GPU, basically.
I think they do an Intel line of sorts.
Intel as well. Okay.
Yeah,
if you want an integrated GPU, you want AMD because they're far more powerful than the Intel ones.
And I've, to be honest, I've managed to, even though I consider this to be a low-end PC, I've managed to play the latest Hitman games, the high fidelity ones. I had to switch, I think, low graphics, and maybe I'm getting about 30 FPS. So
this is something that comes up as well now. I used to, whenever I started a new game, particularly, one that was fairly graphically high fidelity, I'd spend half an hour to an hour just like configuring, tweaking to get that, the best frame rate at the best graphical fidelity. Now if I open a game and it doesn't run smoothly, I just drop it down to minimum and play it, and I don't give a shit. I don't care one iota now.
I think that's starting to rub off on me a little bit, because I was playing golf with your friend, actually with the folks in the room, and I was looking whilst I was, obviously I'd finished a hole excellently, as I often do, and I was waiting for everyone else to catch up. So I had a flick through the settings menu, and there were things like, and I had that in your head when you last told me about that, and it was like draw distance of the foliage. I'm like,
yes.
Why the fuck do it? All right, well, I'll just turn off the foliage, background decoration-y kind of stuff. It's like, okay, I'd quite like, the stuff that I'm actually interacting with to maybe be, decent textures or something. But it's like, well, okay. And then it's like, well, shadows. I could have low quality shadows. They're shadows, aren't they? I just need the essence of a shadow. It doesn't need to be
most of this stuff. Like you'd only notice if you were looking for it. Low res shadows is.
It's a golf ball.
You're only glancing at things. You're not like I don't know.
So I had the texture. I kept the textures on high because that's. But I had lower anti-aliasing. I had, lower filtering. Lower levels of filtering. I can't even remember if I put an FPS limiter on it, just because then, I'm not an FPS fiend, right? Like I don't need a particularly high FPS. I'm happy at 30, 60 is excellent for me. So I have sometimes capped games. I cap Project Zomboid at 30 and I cap, Golf With Your Friends at about 60 if I am capping it. And the only reason for that is just to basically make my computer last longer, I'm not worrying
about
the band.
Cooler, use a little bit less energy.
Yeah, basically, because it doesn't matter to me.
Okay. No, I think there's a big distinction between like Golf With Your Friends. It's an action game. It's things moving quickly and you're looking around a lot. So you want smoothness there.
Mm.
Project Zomboid, it's isometric. It's not turn-based or anything, but it's got more of that feel. So 30 frames a second, who cares? Perfectly fine.
If I'm playing
a turn-based tactics game, which is most of what I play now, it could be running at 10 frames a second. And I wouldn't notice any difference. It's like, who cares?
And also the thing is with Project Zomboid in particular is that there's a bit of a community tradition, I suppose, of turning the blood off because it just adds unnecessary weight to the game. It's one of those things that you don't get that much out of, and you benefit so much by turning it off.
Yep.
So it's.
I did have a proposition for making things feel special again.
Mm-hmm.
How about if we take everybody in the world and we randomly assign them a number between 1 and 15,
mm-hmm.
and then when a game is released, it is randomly assigned a number between 1 and 15, and you can only play games that match with your number.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
All right. Oh, now we were talking in the Discord chat about citizen numbers, if you want to work out. So basically, it's the idea of what
we got there. We got there from domain names. We were talking about because my domain name for my website came up for renewal. I'm not particularly attached to it. I used to have friendo.monster. When that came up for renewal, it was cheaper to just get a different one rather than renew. And because it doesn't matter what my domain name is. I went to a different one. And then we were talking about, well, why not just have IP addresses, really? Like, how often do you type? It's links. So at this point, why not just go back to IP addresses? And then somebody suggested, like, we should be assigned, a handful of domain names at birth. And then those are the ones you get to use. And, and then it came on to, like, using, what was it, like, epoch time as...
So basically, and I'd be interested to see how this would pan out if it was ever tried out, but it's your birth date and time to the millisecond on Unix time, which is, you take, was it January 1st, 1970?
I believe so, yeah.
It's so basically the clock starts at zero on January 1st, 1970, and it just counts upwards in seconds from that. Not upwards in seconds, upwards in is milliseconds like the smallest increment of Unix time or something?
I think seconds. I think just the default, I assume you can go to milliseconds if you want to, but I think the default epoch Unix timestamp is it's just seconds since that point.
But is, what's the chances of someone being born? I mean, you wouldn't necessarily, it would be, I suppose, maybe the when the doctors say you declare born or something, right?
Yeah,
I think
it would have to be something other than, because there's going to be many cases with babies born in the same second, especially
Yeah, but how many babies born in the same millisecond? So
it came up in a game of I can't remember the name of the game. It came up in a game. Mm-hmm. I think it's around about 100 babies born a minute.
Okay.
So, you're going to get second collisions. But maybe rather than going down to milliseconds or whatever, it could just be like so your epoch time plus like a 3-character random string.
Like a number plate.
Yeah, exactly.
Could it be? Oh, could it be the hospital, or like a reference to the hospital? Oh, I don't know. You're starting to get a lot.
How about? Okay, we take the 200 most popular names in the world,
mm-hmm.
and you just get randomly assigned one of those, as well as with your epoch number? Time.
Along with your epoch time.
Yeah. So your epoch time is like your surname, mm. and then the randomly, and we don't care about gender. We just have the top 200 names, and you just get one.
Okay. Yeah.
There's going to be a lot of like Mohammeds and Kim's. What's popular name? I don't even know what a popular name in China is, a first name, a given
Kim.
Name.
Oh, no, first name. Yeah, Kim. Isn't Kim? Or is that that's a surname?
A surname in Korea, I think, is a popular surname in Korea.
I've heard a few people called it. but yeah. You take, I don't know, yeah. Or favorite
animal.
I wonder how many
Kim Kims there are.
What about your zodiac? Pick a random zodiac or you could be assigned alpha male at birth or beta male at birth or those other.
You get assigned a gender randomly.
someone said on I think it's on Mastodon that it's like the alpha male thing or the beta male thing. That's just zodiac for men.
Well, you know, you've heard the thing. I don't know how accurate this is. One of those things I read on social media, but the whole idea of alpha males arose from, I think, studying wolves in captivity.
Mm.
But what we've realized more recently is wolves in captivity don't behave like wolves in the wild. So the whole alpha male idea is a bit wobbly to begin with, even when talking about, you know.
Yeah. Well, it's like people in prison don't act like people outside of prison.
Well, yeah, absolutely, yeah.
But you know, do you want to move on to our game of the
tier list?
Oh my god! If there's someone in the chat that's like, when do they get to it? 2 hours in.
You gotta wait. It's worth waiting for. It might not be worth waiting for, but
it's not worth waiting for. The best bit. We've peaked. We've already peaked.
Also, anybody who's watching this, roll a d20. If you don't have one physically, I'm sure you can find one online. If you don't get a number 3, you can't watch the tier list.
Okay, yeah. d20. Oh, and if you roll it, what happens if they get a d1?
If they get a 20 or a 1,
a critical fail.
If you get a 1, they have to unsubscribe.
Okay, and
never watches again.
If they get a 20. Then
if they get a 20, they have to set up a Patreon and donate to it. For them, not for us.
They have to make their own Patreon and donate to themselves.
Make their own Patreon and donate to it, yeah.
So they're just giving Patreon money.
This episode sponsored by Patreon. Oh, we're sponsored by video.thepolarbear.co.uk.
Mm.
Have you ever used YouTube and thought it was terrible? Well, we've got the product for you.
No, we've got the product for us. And we want if you got money to spare and you want to support the stuff that we do, then Hamish is the guy to, like, he's got a Ko-fi and he basically runs the servers that our videos run on, and you know, he's a solid guy. He makes content himself, and so if you want to basically support us, you're supporting us by supporting him.
Yeah.
Which is do that. And
also do be aware you're supporting his filthy retro computer habit as well.
Yeah. But it's only filthy in terms of the physical dirt, and he's cleaning them out, so the thing is about Hamish, right? And I said this to his face, right? Is that a lot of the stuff that he's into would just do so well on TikTok. He hates the corporate.
No, I agree, yeah. Wear. And I think like not to be like superficial, but the Scottish accent and his physical demeanor, I think he'd do fucking great on TikTok.
Yeah, like the soft voice, you know, softly spoken voice.
Yeah. And also the grump, you know, I'm a grumpy old man kind of thing. Like, you know, combined with him actually being lovely most of the time, like, beautiful. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And yeah. Like, because the cleaning of the knobs and the, you know, the inside. Yeah. It's just be like, all right. So we've got the tier list up. What do we want to start with? You can see the logos. You probably need a.
Oh yeah, I need you to stream at me.
Right. Okay. I'm going to completely botch up now. Okay. let's watch me mess this up. Right. Okay. So I'm going to go to, right, and then I do a screen share, and then I go to create the Linux tier list like that. Now that's just messed me up now. Well, how am I going to do this? If I go to okay. Right. Okay. Maybe, what I'm going to do.
You switch.
Is,
go on. I was going to say, can you just switch OBS over to this Discord window?
If I do that, it doesn't stream in the little window. It says your stream is right. And I don't.
We'll just switch OBS just over to the tier list for now. Forget about the cameras while we're doing this. Unless it's easy.
Hang on a minute. I think. Are you sure? Unchecking share my screen doesn't end your stream. Da 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 da. Oh, hang on a minute. That doesn't do. It's. hang on a minute. Okay. What I can do then. This is just going to be a mess. Right. Okay. This is gonna look really weird for a few seconds until it doesn't.
While you're sorting this, I'll quickly go for a piss, so I'm fully empty bladdered for this.
Good thinking.
For our vitriol.
Okay. Okay, this is gonna look weird for a second. But then I can just do this. And this. Okay, excellent. Okay. Just making a cup of tea as well. Oh, almost had it. Okay, there we go. Perfect. Look at this. Professionalism. Okay. So, it's done by logo. So this is a tier list. I don't know if those of you at home are familiar with what a tier list is, but basically, we're going to look at a bunch of the most sort of recognizable Linux distributions, and we're going to put them in a list that goes from S, which is basically A star, A, B, C, D, F, and there's a bottom one, never tried. So, okay. I just gave a rundown of the basics. You can see the stream okay?
Yeah, beautiful.
Excellent. Got your cup of tea?
Kettle's boiling, almost there.
Okay, all right. Shall we start with the easy one that we talked about earlier, Arch Linux? Now, is this an S?
It's S tier, isn't it?
It's S tier.
If for the kind of person it's designed for, it's the perfect distribution.
Yeah.
You want cutting edge, rolling release. You want everything under your own control. You want to choose what you want to use and what you don't want to use. It's unbeatable. Well, yeah. Almost unbeatable. We'll get
almost
to that.
Unbeatable. I'm also going to say, should we put Debian into S as well for the same reasons?
For the other end of the spectrum, if you just don't want to worry about it, don't care whether it's up to date, just want it to fucking work and stay working, S tier. Yeah.
And also, I think it's worth bearing in mind, both of those work well on the server. Opposite ends of the spectrum, but a lot of people, particularly people that play games, really like Arch, partly because with Arch, I don't know if you necessarily want to run a server on Arch for like 10 or 20 years, but if you want to spin up one for a couple of years or, you know, for a period of time that you're just playing a game for, then that's absolutely, you know, super useful.
I mean, for servers, the argument against Arch is an update can potentially break it. But the argument for Arch is you're never going to have to reinstall. I think you were going to ask me earlier what's in the last time I nuked and paved on this machine, right?
Yeah.
Never. I installed Arch when I bought it, and I've never had to reinstall, because with Arch, you don't really need to.
So you can switch back to X without having to nuke and pave?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
I mean, you can do that on any distro. It's just that with Arch, it's more sort of obvious that you know, that is
or expected behavior, perhaps. I mean,
I think it's also... I think something you can get on, say on you're on Ubuntu. This definitely happened back in the day. You're on Ubuntu, and you're like, I'm going to try Kubuntu, which you can just install. You can install a package which essentially converts your Arch to Kubuntu. And then you're like, oh, I don't think I like Kubuntu. I'll uninstall the Kubuntu stuff. But then your splash screen is still KDE. It's like your splash screen will be KDE, your login will be GNOME, and then your icons will be KDE, and your pointer will be, you know, it's all mixed up. You don't get that kind of thing on Arch.
No, and you don't get that thing with also like window managers so much as well.
No.
Which is what I quite like, you know, where you stand with them. On that note, should we have a look at, okay, Ubuntu, because this is going to be one. this is a tricky one, right? Because are we talking about Ubuntu today, or are we talking about Ubuntu when it was like making waves?
I'm gonna start by saying so for me, it can't be S tier if it's a corporate distro.
Okay, yeah, no, I agree with that.
Because it's not for me. I mentioned this on Freddy the other day. If it's not run by a community, it's not really open source, because it's part of the point of open source is the primary and kind of only concern is making this the best possible software for the users.
Yeah.
If a corporation's in control of it, then profit is part of the equation. So if they get more profit by making it a bit worse for users, they will do that. But respect to what Canonical did with Ubuntu back in the day, when we've talked about it before. You installed SUSE back in the day, and there was like 9 million text editors, 9 million hex editors, 9 million word processors, 9 million, and Ubuntu came along and said, how about we just have one of each? We pick one, and that's the one you get. You can install the others if you want, but by default, we just have one of everything. And I think that was huge. That was huge for Linux. And also, they did a great job popularizing Linux. Whenever anybody talked about Linux on the media, it was Ubuntu. Like, it actually got it a bit of recognition. So they've done a lot of good. They've also done a lot of stupid things, which would, you know, no point going into.
Snaps so is the big one for me.
Sorry, what is?
Snaps.
Snaps. Yeah.
I think everything else is forgivable apart from Snaps. If I'm honest, I mean,
well, there was a thing where they were advertising to you in the overlay. I can't remember what it's called, but there was an overlay where they had like it was sending data to Amazon, or it was doing adverts, or something dodgy like that.
It had a thing with see again. That's definitely a put mark against it, but they weren't doing that with Kubuntu. They weren't doing that with the spin-offs. But the spin-offs now have to walk in lockstep with Snap. You know, so
For me, the things against Ubuntu is Unity being a thing that they were working in house rather than just working with GNOME or something. That was kind of stupid. There's something I'm forgetting. There was they request for Ubuntu projects, they require copyright assignment, which I'm fine with if it's the GNU project, because again, they're not run by a corporation, but I'm not okay giving a corporation, you know, copyright to the code. That's no, fuck off. And some others that I forget. I would say B is fair, but what's your argument?
I mean, B, I guess, if Snaps weren't a fundamental part of the equation, it would be A. The more I think about Snaps, the more I want to pretend to receive, but I can't because they've done a lot.
Yeah. And there's I don't think there's any circumstance where I'd recommend Ubuntu to somebody now.
I don't think of Snaps as open source because they're not.
No, they're not, yeah. Also, again, it's another insisting on doing it in-house rather than just contribute to Flatpak.
Yeah.
Have your own Flatpak, like repository or whatever you call it with Flatpaks. Fine, but yeah, just why have two of the same thing?
So bouncing off of Ubuntu, we've got, let's do KDE Neon. How familiar are you with KDE Neon?
I've never used it, and I'm only vaguely familiar. What's it based on? It's a KDE spin, obviously.
It's an Ubuntu LTS base with a KDE up-to-date.
Now, are we going to do all of the Ubuntu but something? Because as far as I'm concerned, that's Ubuntu.
Okay.
It's Ubuntu that hasn't done all the good that Ubuntu's done. To me, that's a pointless bit. Unless I'm missing something. I've not used it. I'm not particularly familiar with it, but I don't see the point.
Maybe it's worth dropping it down to a C then, because basically it's showcasing.
What's the sell?
It's, It's a showcase for KDE. It's the latest and greatest KDE.
Is it put out by KDE?
I think it.
Why not just install KDE on your whatever distro you're using and have a look at
KDE? Well, a lot of people, I mean, Arch gets you almost pretty close. Now I'll do KDE now. I'm just going to quickly look them up to see. I want to know if they do snaps. They're on Telegram. straight from KDE. More than ever, people want cutting edge, yada, yada, yada. Try it on shells. That's interesting. It's maintained by KDE webmasters. Okay, yeah. So it looks like it's an official KDE. So it looks like almost like it's a showcase distribution. So concept distribution almost.
I would want to drop that down, and that seems like a very neat... If we're talking about distros for people to actually use, it's a different kettle of fish, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's like having a... What's the distro that's just... I can't even remember. That software for... Gparted. There's a distro that's just like you put it in, it's Gparted.
Yeah,
it's akin to that, really. It's not really a distro.
That makes sense. Okay. So what about Linux Mint? Now...
Go on.
Okay, so Linux Mint now, they have two base. So their main version is based on Ubuntu. However, they've taken a stand against snaps.
Mm-hmm.
They have created Cinnamon Desktop, which is a fine enough desktop, but they have made efforts to make it so that there are, so that it's not just a Linux Mint affair, that you can get Cinnamon that runs on Debian.
Yeah.
You can get, I believe that one of the Ubuntu community are bringing out an Ubuntu Cinnamon that might be officially blessed at this point. Not 100% certain on that, but I hear people talking about it. So Mint have made some contributions. They've also done a lot of duplicating works, like their text editors and all this kind of stuff are forked from like GNOME 2 text editors or something, and it's just like another text editor for, you know,
I mean, it would have been forks rather than starting from scratch.
Yeah, but
like as Ubuntu itself would do.
Yeah, I feel that though that they could have supported. I know they thought about this. I know these were considerations and stuff, and there's probably a whole bunch of context that I'm missing. So, but also, see, Mint have this great out of the box. Okay, my parents both use Mint. I even have got to the stage where I taught them how to install it, download it, burn it to USB, all that themselves. They're relatively adept. I don't want to say parents thinking that they're you know, old biddies or anything. They're perfectly capable, intelligent people. They're just not hugely computer people. They've got an eye for it, but that's, you know. They installed a fucking printer on it the other day without any... I didn't even know. They didn't even fucking tell me. Which is, as far as I'm concerned, fucking magic. So, you know, have we finally cracked...
The way I see Linux Mint is it's Ubuntu done right. It's kind of almost a Debian in that, like, it just works. It's not going to fuck around with you. It's if you want that aspect of Debian, but you want it a bit more up to date and a bit more, you know, consumery, then it's that. It's run by a community. It's not owned by a corporation. Yeah, it's Ubuntu done right. For me, Cinnamon is the only mark against it. not being a fan of Cinnamon myself, and also don't like just work with GNOME. Don't fork it.
It works with Mate, and is there still an XFCE version? So it's
I used Linux Mint for a while, for maybe like 18 months back in the day, a long time ago. So yeah, given all that, I would say, and the people who use Mint, they fucking love it.
Yeah.
And it does seem to be a straightforward, it just works kind of distro. I'd say S tier.
I'm biased because Linux Mint was the one that tipped me over to Linux being primary and Windows being secondary. The reason for it was that they actually had some guts and included the codecs as part of, you know, like MP3.
that was the main stuff. Differentiating thing back in the day, wasn't it? Oh, like they seen stuff as well, but the big differentiator was it was Ubuntu with codecs
and widescreen support. It had widescreen support before Ubuntu. Way back in the days, you had to fiddle with this old file called x.org, which, oh my god, I don't even like, I always fucked it up. So the fact that Linux Mint worked because I didn't, again, for the people that it's for, it's perfect. The Linux Mint community absolutely love it. Which I suppose is more to than can be said for the Manjaro, which has had divided opinions because it takes the stance. But I think now they even include some they don't really care about non-free software at any level of their distribution. I think last time I used Manjaro, Steam came pre-installed, which is an interesting choice, but fine, okay. but it also has options for, I think, like non-free things like office suites and stuff like that. And it's like, do we still need, like, if you're not in a corporate environment, do you still need anything other than, is LibreOffice fine? Like, sure, it doesn't have every single bell and whistle under the sun, but if you just want to make a document or a spreadsheet, it's fine, you know?
For me, Manjaro is Arch done very, very wrong. you take Arch, you make it kind of rolling, but not with a two-week thing. But they add layers. So the beauty of Arch is its simplicity. So you take Arch, you add layers of complexity on top. Fair enough in principle. But then those layers of complexity don't actually work. So on Arch, I ran Manjaro for a while. On Arch, if I want to install the NVIDIA graphics drivers, right? Mm-hmm. I type pacman-s NVIDIA. Hit enter a couple more times. It's installed and it works. Mm-hmm. Manjaro made a tool for installing your graphics card driver, which is fiddly, finicky, confusing, and doesn't work. Like, I would install NVIDIA through the Manjaro tool, and it didn't work. My system would not show me graphics. Yeah, don't know. I can't remember why. It was some stupid reason. But they took something and made it more complicated and more fragile. And I think when people criticize Arch and say, you know, it's fragile, it can break, it breaks when you update, that's not really been my experience with Arch, but that was very much my experience on Manjaro. Plus, they had that incident that I can't remember the details of, that just demonstrated that they don't really understand technology or security. There was that sort of breach or potential breach or security certificates co-opted. I can't remember the details, so I don't want to thingy. But that was a huge faux pas for somebody running a Linux distro. For me, Manjaro is an easy F tier. If somebody was thinking about running Manjaro, I would warn them against it. I don't think anybody should run Manjaro. You're just creating problems for yourself.
I have a better experience with Manjaro. I switched to Manjaro because I bought a relatively new graphics card at the time, GTX 970 or something like that.
Yeah.
And Ubuntu didn't support it. I don't know if I had much luck with the PPA, which was the thing that you'd use at the time. Manjaro supported it out of the box. It was easy to install. One of the things I did like about Manjaro back in the day is, first off, it comes with XFCE, a nice XFCE out-of-the-box desktop, and it is the easiest to get from Nuke and Pave install to up and running. You know, it's the quickest.
When I first installed Manjaro, I had a good experience with it. It was over time that it's the thing, everything that it does on top of Arch is worse and fragile. That's my problem with it. And over time, that becomes evident. And when you break something on Manjaro, or when something breaks on Manjaro, it's virtually impossible to fix. Whereas on Arch, it's always trivial to fix.
I have had updates on Manjaro that have just given me the grub menu.
That was supposed to be the guarantee with the two week delay to the rolling. The guarantee was supposed to be that wouldn't happen on Manjaro, but it happened more on Manjaro than it happened on Arch.
Yeah, sometimes it was because of course it wasn't. It was sometimes versions would get out of things, that dependency versions would get out of sync.
Yeah,
in a way that
that's exactly Arch, the way they were claiming to curate it. That's exactly what shouldn't have happened.
Mm. But also what's a bit interesting is that they say that they're doing security updates in real time.
Mm.
So that feels like a really weird, complicated way of doing it. One of the things I did like in terms of thinking of it as Arch with training wheels is that they had a kernel select manager, like a GUI kernel manager. And for someone when at the time that I wasn't super familiar with kernels and how they worked and all that kind of stuff and the difference between different kernels, it allowed me to switch between kernels relatively trivially and in a way that was like good for
but it, again, if you're the kind of person who needs a GUI to change kernels, then I don't think you're the kind of person who should be on a distro where you need to change kernels to solve problems. You should be on a more stable distro, I think. That might sound a bit elitist, but I don't mean it in the, you know, you're using a GUI, you're an idiot kind of way, but those seem to be like competing desires. Like, you'd be much better on Linux Mint at that point, where that is never going to be a problem.
Yeah. I don't know if it deserves an F, because
I think it, for me, it is the worst distro, because it's the worst of all worlds. It's the fragility of Arch magnified without the benefits of, you know, of a Linux Mint or whatever.
Okay. I'll put it on there, because the thing is, you know, they, like with Linux Mint, they say, look, we, you know, and I think they've held this line for decades at this point, because it's getting on a bit now in age. They held the line that we prefer open source, but if we hit up against a wall that we can only get through with some proprietary stuff,
yeah,
then we'll do it.
Which is essentially where you and I are, right?
I think that's where everyone is.
Yeah,
you know, it's because at the end of the day, Wi-Fi cards without firmware blobs and, you know, binary, you know.
I mean, that's not to say. I mean, I respect Debian's stance of free software only. Like, I'm not saying they should have, you know, non-free stuff in their repos. No, don't. That's great. That, I mean, they do. They have the non-free repo, but you know what I mean, in the default install. But that's a perfectly rational approach.
Yeah. So, all right. Since we were talking about some things that distros are based on, others, let's go Pop OS then.
It started really strong, didn't it? It seemed really good at the start, and now they've gone down the path of they've gone down the canonical path, and I think it's a function of being owned by a corporation. You always end up wanting to make your own thing, and yeah, so it gets marked down immediately for being a corporate distro for me, so it can't go above an A. And I would say, yeah, I mean, I think Ubuntu with some, you know, with more recent graphics drivers. You know, they definitely marketed it towards, you know, being the Ubuntu for gamers. I think that's a good idea, and I think that's what they had to begin with, but now they're veering off into something else, and that's a shame.
They had a really nice implementation of GNOME.
Yeah.
We've
given Ubuntu a lot of props for historical things that they did, you know, popularizing Linux, all that kind of stuff, and I don't think it deserves that. So a C makes sense to me, but you should have the last say if you disagree.
I want to know if Pop does, like, what their stance on snaps are. That's the deciding thing. are they taking it seems like they're relatively, like, snaps are an optional extra, not part of the, I think. I just did a quick search here. And most of what comes up when I talk about snaps on Pop OS is how to install and manage snaps. So, unless I'm wrong, it seems like they've taken a little bit of a stance against snaps. But they make Flatpaks easy to bring in, but that makes sense for a distribution of that type. So, I would say a B. I think it's. Do you think it's worth? I think it's worth a B.
But this is, somebody's got to have the final say. I'm happy. I'm happy for you to have the final say.
B and a half. Okay. I'll tell you what. I'll give it a B for benefit of the doubt, because we're not familiar with the Cosmic desktop environment, but they've done some iterations. In my head, if I'm thinking about the last version of it, I tried with a really nice GNOME implementation. Then I'm going to give it a B, but that's a, you know,
yeah.
Okay. How familiar are you with MX Linux?
MX Linux, I have heard of, and that's about as far as it goes. I'm sure every now and then I Google it and go, oh, it's that one, and then forget, which one is it?
It's based on Debian, but I forget which one now. Is it maybe Debian testing? But it takes bits from other Linuxes, from older Linuxes. Oh, okay. I have used it in the past for some substantial periods of time.
Wikipedia says MX Linux is a Linux distribution based on a Debian stable and using core Antix components with additional software created or packaged by the MX community. What's Antix?
It's an old older distribution that is
based
also
on Metis. Antix is based on Metis, so yeah. Okay, I know nothing about this one, so.
This is a little bit like Debian with training wheels or Debian with extra bits.
Okay.
Debian for people that are curious about Debian for people that are curious about Debian, but maybe aren't. It's very good, nice out of the box, but it's a bit weird. Like the default environment is XFCE. They put the panel on the left hand side. which is kind of interesting. For laptops, it actually makes a lot of sense because someone told me that it's much more comfortable ergonomically to move your hand to the left than it is to curl your finger down.
I think it makes sense on a desktop as well. If I ever have like a taskbar or a dock type thing, I always put it on the left if you can.
Interesting. Mine's at the bottom.
Well, the reason for having it on a side is that, because, we spend a lot of time in a web browser, and horizontal pixels are more valuable than vertical pixels are more valuable than horizontal pixels. Like, shrinking a browser window like this doesn't lose you anything, whereas shrinking a browser window like this loses you, a couple of lines of text.
Yeah, I might actually have a think about trying to work it out. So I think that MX Linux is, I think it's an A. I like it. It's just nice.
Produce, yeah. I don't know enough to comment, really.
I would say, and again, similar to Mint, I mean, I don't even know why it's not an S because it's not Debian, I guess.
Yeah, I don't think unless they improve upon it substantially, I don't think that any of the ones based on something can really, Linux Mint being the exception, like the derivative distros, I don't think can be S tier, really, with no. Linux Mint being a prominent counterexample.
Mint has done a lot of Canonical's innovations have been in service of the corporate side of it.
Yeah.
Almost all of Mint's improvements, they've all been to the benefit of the community and the user base.
I mean, it's fundamental. It's a de-shitified Ubuntu.
Yes. Yeah. Okay, let's do OpenSUSE. This is ominously not talked about on this channel because I don't think either of us really know much about it, really.
It's kind of it's a corporate distro like Red Hat, right? It's one of those distros. If you're running a company and you want Linux with support, you're either going to go with OpenSUSE or Red Hat or maybe Ubuntu. I think they offer support. So it's not a hobbyist distro. It's not the kind of distro you generally run at home on your desktop. There's people who do, of course. Mm. It's got Yast, which I remember wrestling with back in the day. I mean. Really, I mean, I have tried OpenSUSE now and then over the years, but my only significant time spent with it was probably in around like 2001 or 2. Mm. And judging it on that basis seems a little bit unfair.
Same, like but, SUSE was my first distribution. Came on the front of Linux format, yeah. I think it was, yeah. Or something similar. I enjoyed it, and it was good in 1997.
Yeah,
I think I might have tried it. Yeah, I'm sure I've done a distro review video about it like 10 years ago or something, and I think it was just like fine. I mean, I'm tempted to say B because
I think it's a bit bland. It does a lot of stuff that we don't need. It's not really intended. Yeah, it's not really intended for us. So yeah, I assume it's good at what it does. So yeah, B is fine.
B is like the corporate, like, decent tier.
Okay, everything we just said again about... Actually, I was going to say everything we just said about SUS also applies to... We should also mention OpenSUS is the free spin of their corporate. So it is to... OpenSUS is to SUS as Fedora is to Red Hat, roughly. Or CentOS is to Red Hat, maybe.
Okay, Fedora.
I was just going to deal with Red Hat, because I was going to say everything we said about SUS applies to Red Hat, but I will say everything we said about SUS applies to Red Hat, except that Red Hat... do tend to stick their fucking oar in because of their position, because they're the most profitable Linux company. They get a lot of, they get and then also grab a lot of control over projects, right? They took what's his face systemd dude in house, so they had a big say over systemd and pushing systemd.
Leonard Pottering,
yeah. That's the one, yeah. Same for like GNOME. They're kind of de facto in control of GNOME, and they direct its. You know, GNOME is really because they make software for servers, and they make software for workstations. And for the workstations, they want a standard desktop that you can't really fuck around with, that works the same way, so that companies can make documentation as to how to do things, right? Mm-hmm. And that's why GNOME is as locked down as it is. So for me. They're, and it's corporate, obviously, they're a little bit evil. I think they use
owned by IBM.
Of course they're owned by IBM now, yeah.
Which are actually a legit evil corporation. I'm going to Google this, but are they not the company that developed the numbering tattoo system or whatever it was, or like... For Auschwitz
No, they sold computers to the Nazis as well. Yeah, for when I say computer, rudimentary computers, obviously. For cataloging the people they were genociding and stuff. Yeah, I mean, a lot of companies did business with the Nazis. You know, the Coca-Cola famously did business with the Nazis.
Hugo Boss.
To expect a capitalist corporation to not do that is to not understand capitalism, I think.
Oh, there's a book called IBM and the Holocaust by Edwin Black, and there's a Wikipedia article about it.
Yep. Holocaust aside, I kind of a little bit of respect for IBM, because it's, we were talking about something the other day related to
this. That's a soundbite, isn't it? Putting the Holocaust aside. Okay.
They are at least openly evil. They don't pretend to be anything else. They don't pretend, oh, we're fluffy, we're your friend, we're arm around you, like Google and Apple and, you know. They're not like that. They're like, yeah, no, we're fucking evil. You want us to do evil for you? We'll fucking do it. To show us who needs kicking.
And to be fair, okay, in my opinion, they do business better than Canonical. They're a better business. They're better at their job than Canonical.
They had a hell of a running start.
Yeah, well, yeah.
But Red Hat itself, I don't like the undue influence they exert over software projects that is not in the user's interest. So I want to see them knocked down to a C personally, but I think you should have final say.
I don't think we can knock them down to a C without knocking Canonical down to a C.
But Canonical did do so much good in opening things up, which Red Hat's never been, because Canonical was, I mean, at the start, Canonical was like, we want to see a computer in every classroom in Africa. That, you know, they had all these lofty sort of, they didn't follow through on it, but. Had all these lofty ideals. It was very consumer focused, whereas, you know, Red Hat was corporate. From Red Hat is not interested in the consumer desktop, right?
No, I'm not pretending that they are. They give a lot of people in the community jobs.
That's true, and you know they're a billion dollar. I don't know if they're actually a billion, but you know they make a ton of money. I think the way they do dividends is based on market growth rather than profits or something. So they're incentivized to invest rather than to, you know, just, yeah.
I think that...
Some good.
Yeah, I think that they have a point with the way that they've locked down GNOME.
But it's very much to their ends. They're not interested in us. They're not doing that for us. They're doing that, you know, for their corporate workstations, which...
But that applies to all the beer. That's all the beer tiers, though.
Less Ubuntu. I mean, Ubuntu have gone that way, yeah.
And Snaps. Yeah. Snaps are closed. Yeah. More closed than
I just think Red Hat are a little bit more evil than the other three.
Well, yeah, but this isn't an evil tier list.
I mean, we can use anything, can't we, to judge these distros?
Well, yeah, fair enough. But I mean, the thing is,
don't like the logo. Stupid logo as well.
They are. I mean, they are associated with Auschwitz. So, I mean, you don't get much more evil than that. Really, do you?
They are associated with Auschwitz.
I'm trying to use language that you can't pin. They can't pin on me too much. Were associated with
Red Hat, I mean, or Nazis. So.
I mean, you can say that about a lot of companies. I think, wasn't the guy, the IKEA guy, wasn't he a bit of
God,
the,
they do. They do have a black and red logo.
Oh my God, yeah. And a fedora now, you know.
Let's put them down. No, we've they got to be a C.
Really?
Yeah.
I can't defend the Auschwitz company.
After linking them to the...
Oh, okay, but then give me that fedora be a B then. Because... there's a lot of fedora, there's a lot of Red Hat that applies to fedora, but
fedora, for looking at it just as a distro that I've used, and I did use for maybe 6 months to a year at one point, it's a very nice distro to use.
I like it,
but I hate everything about it. I never felt good using it, do you know what I mean? Like, it worked perfectly well, but I hated myself for using it.
The package manager is not as good as the others.
No, it's horrible. Yeah,
slower more than anything else. The way that they did third party codecs and whatnot was just pretty torturous. RPM fusion.
I hate that they, it's a corporate fucking distro. Why have a very strong free software thing when you're a corporate distro, and then when this is more like your consumer spin of the corporate distro? Also, Fedora's purpose is for people to do free QA for Red Hat. Mm-hmm. I'm never a huge fan of that. You know, if they're doing QA for Red Hat and you're making billions of dollars, fucking pay them. It's corporate. It works very well, but I don't like anything else about it. Like, just if you just put it on my computer and didn't tell me what it was, I'd be like, yeah, it's a good distro. It works very well. But every other thing I dislike.
It's another early distro for me that I adopted. I think it was the first. I think it worked better on my laptop, my first proper like Linux laptop, than Ubuntu. So I think that's why I sort of went with it as my first main Linux operating system. I mean, it's not as bad. It's Red Hat, but like nicer. Like, as in, like, more less evil.
It's not really, but it is entirely controlled by Red Hat. I mean, they pretend otherwise as well, which I don't like. You know, it's like, no, we've got nothing to do with it.
It's quite new. It's quite cutting edge. You know, it's well put. Yeah. It is well put together in some way. Like the distro.
I don't know anybody who uses it. Why would you choose it over a community? Like, you know, why would you choose it over Mint or, you know, depending on your direction, Debian or Arch? Why would you go like, yeah, I want this, but corporate?
It's got pretty new software. It had early Wayland support. They are kind of leading the way with Wayland, if that's something.
Yeah, but no, leading the way because Red Hat are pushing it on everybody again.
Red Hat wants
that, you know, unified. They don't want a diversity of window managers. They want everybody using fucking GNOME.
All valid points. That's why I put it at a B.
I think it deserves a C. Also associated with Auschwitz.
Associated with an association associated with Auschwitz.
Again, final say to you.
If you're going to put Red Hat at C, I'm going to put Fedora at B. Because I think there's a lot of good things to it. I do think they've put some good contributions. I think Arch Toasty was running it for a while.
But he works at Red Hat. Of course he was.
Yeah, it very much confused me with the name, to be honest. did he used to run Arch or...
Oh, right. Yeah, no, you know what? I never thought of that.
But great. I don't know. I haven't managed to catch a live stream of his lately. Does he go on Twitch or...
So is French Ghosty the French Arch Toasty? Because I do sometimes go to call Ghosty Toasty.
I've definitely in my brain made the switch over, but I don't think they're related.
I think they're brothers.
But I think he was on Twitch. But the thing is, I fall off Twitch. So many adverts on there. It's just
horrible interface.
There's loads of people I like on Twitch, and I just don't ever catch them because the email notifications, and also you have to be there at like the exact right time. And it's like, well, you know, the thing is, of course, everyone streams in the evening at the exact same time. So it's like, you know, it's not like YouTube where you can roll up a playlist. So
exactly.
Puppy Linux.
I mean, we should really do CentOS next.
Oh, go on then, CentOS.
If we're doing the whole... So CentOS is Red Hat made free, as it should be. So it's got to be higher than Red Hat, so it's a B.
Hang on, is this is the CentOS logo, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's a B, but isn't there something... I mean, if Canonical, I feel Canonical should be dropped down to a C by this. I feel like we've recalibrated the list a little bit.
We can't have Canonical on a C, given that the good that they did do in terms of redefining what a Linux distro should be, just the form of it. I can't. If you drop in Ubuntu, I can't have Ubuntu being lower than Fedora. Fedora have done fuck all.
Well, with the scar that Auschwitz has left on the world, you know, I mean,
and then Pop's got to drop down as well.
Yeah,
I'd be happy with everything we've got on B being on C, apart
but
from Zeus.
Wasn't CentOS? Isn't there politics with CentOS? CentOS isn't CentOS anymore, is it? What happened to CentOS?
It was CentOS, and then Red Hat was like, you can't keep giving away our stuff for free, so they made it harder. And then did they take them in house or something? I've stopped following it at a certain point because I don't care, but something happened. I mean, it's the corporate world that we're not really, it's not our, it's a different kind of Linux when we're talking about the corporate stuff, really.
Yeah, what is CentOS now? Is it still the thing that people run mind tests on?
There was scientific Linux as well, which was another freeing up of Red Hat, wasn't it?
I'm completely unfamiliar with scientific Linux. CentOS system continued to...
I've never used it.
Okay, so CentOS Stream 8... information up on group upgrades, board meeting recapped August 24. I'm looking at the news. Community driven free software effort. But there's been like, isn't there like Alma Linux and Rocky Linux?
Yeah, and they're all kind of the same thing, right?
But they spun off because B makes sense to me.
Yeah, fine, leave it on B.
Right, I'm going to need a little bit of a reference now. Is that peppermint? I don't know.
I don't think it's peppermint. The ones we don't know, we should probably just skip over. We don't need to do.
Well, there's some. I'll have a quick scan on DistroWatch to see what.
Some of these are a bit kind of obscure.
Okay, so because I know this one, I've seen this one. Is this Alpine Linux?
If it is, I know nothing about it.
Yeah, I don't know. Where's Alpine? Where's Alpine Linux? So it's 28 on DistroWatch. It's independently based from Norway, a community-developed operating system designed for routers, firewalls, VPN, voice over IP boxes,
okay.
Containers, so servers, really, yada, yada.
I'm sure it's great at what it does, but I'm not interested.
We'll stick
but
it
I mean,
in the never
by which I mean I'm not personally interested.
Yeah.
Puppy, we're going to do Puppy. Puppy's great.
At least an A. I mean, I kind of want to maybe an S tier.
No, I don't think it. No. It's Debian slimmed down, right?
It's independent. Independent.
Is it? I thought it was Debian or something.
It mimics a lot of. Well, there are different. It's very complicated.
Right,
there are versions. There are versions of Debian. Versions of Puppy based on other stuff.
Okay.
Go on, try and make sense of that with this.
Yeah, I'm reading the it does seem to be its own thing. That's cool. But it is the reason I would say not S tier is because it's a special use case one. I know it was the one wasn't it the one that people used to whichever PlayStation it was that could technically run Linux, that it was Puppy Linux that people there was Yellow Dog and there was Puppy, I think, that people ran on the PlayStation, and that's pretty fucking cool. But it's a slimmed down Linux for very low resource devices, right? Which
I've saved some apps.
I would say it's a niche use case, and I don't think it could be an S for that.
I mean, I say revive some ancient computers with Puppy Linux. It's the one that you also have on cool. A pen drive. So
yeah. I think it's very cool, but. Sorry, you're gone.
So, but it's a little bit concept-y, similar to MX Linux, I guess, in that
kind
of way.
Yeah, I think FA is fair for that.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, A is still very good, right? Like, there's a distinct difference, right, between SNA and then the rest. Like, they
are, definitely.
You know, because the thing is, in reality, there's not really anything Puppy can do that would put it into S tier then by that stretch. You know, I suppose S tier has to have that sort of inclusivity that, like, almost anyone can just pick up and go, whereas I guess Puppy...
Yeah, because it's kind of like there's a distro, actually I think it's BSD based, but let's pretend it's not. I can't remember what it's called, but there's a distro that people put on routers, right? To free routers up from being, you know, having the corporate software on there. It's open up your router and do whatever you want with it. And I think that's a fucking amazing project. If we were just judging projects, I would say that's, you know, that is S tier, but it's so specific and niche that it's not like, oh yeah, I enjoy using this day to day. It's not about that. It's something else.
Yeah. Okay. What other logos? Oh, what about Pure OS? This is a peculiar one.
I've heard the name. I don't know what it is. What's Pure OS?
I think it's free, like Debian, but Superfos. I think. I'm going to just double check that one.
I don't tend to love distros that could be replaced by a config file. Like, I don't know if we're going to do Arco Linux, but I think Arco Linux, that's just an installer for Arch, right? So what essentially that is a bash script, and that is not a Linux distro. The difference between Arco and Arch, if I'm right about what it is a bash script. And I kind of feel the same way about Pure OS. If you just, I'm pretty sure there's a setting you can say in Debian to never include, you know, nothing that isn't fully free software. So
yeah. The FSF have, is it the F? Yeah. Yeah. I was going to say FSB there for a second. No, different. the FSF have, like, they're very highly strung on what they bless as a distro.
Yeah.
Pure OS is one of the FSF blessed distros because...
Yeah, but the only reason Debian isn't is because of, like, trademark things, right? Debian is actually very strict about what's free software, but they're softer also on trademarks than... And when you're getting down to that granularity, I don't... Who fucking cares? Is that... Who's that helping?
I mean, it depends what day you ask me on, to be honest, because it's like, you know how Hamish just hates the corporate social media world, right? Like, he hates it with a burning passion. He's got, you know, he's got his Matrix server, streams on Owncast, got PeerTube, you know, he is fully... And
he's putting his money where his mouth is, so to speak.
And he's put, like, his money where his mouth is. And recently we've managed to drag him kicking and screaming.
Don't tell people that. He's never used Discord in his fucking life.
I admire Hamish's steadfastness to those principles. Yeah. And I almost sort of envy them in a way. Like, I like to think that I do what I can. But, he's a man of principle, and that's and I kind of like,
but if you're using Debian and setting it to use only the free repos, if that's not free enough for you and you need to use a different fucking distro to be even more free, I think you've taken a wrong turn somewhere. I think there's a better use for the time that you spent considering that and doing it.
Where would that put Pure OS then?
For me, I think I'd stick it in never tried. It's, I don't care. I don't care about what it's doing, honestly.
See, I'm getting a...
Debian's pretty fucking free. Come on, like, Debian had to do fucking Ice Weasel because they couldn't include Firefox or whatever. Like, how free do you want to be?
How about...
It's a pedantic distro.
It's a pedantic... I mean, I've used it and it's fine, but it is very much Debian, but super free. Mm. I don't know. Actually, I think you're talking me out of something. Like, I don't know, because it's like a lot of it is Debian, and it's like, is it going to get this?
How about this? Anything you put in S tier has got to be something you could see yourself using full time.
I'm not saying it should be in S tier.
Anything you put in A tier should be something that you'd be happy to use for a year or two. Everything in B should be anything you'd be happy to use for like 6 months or so, and you know, so on and so on. Would you be willing to use Pure OS, Chris?
Is this going to be completely underwritten by Flatpaks? Because if it's just a matter of just like...
No. If you're using Pure OS, you're using it because you feel as they do about free software.
And this is my main OS. I'm not using anything else.
I mean, that's just a framing device, just to say, like, if you're rating it that highly, like, would you be? I mean, I'm not saying this should be like the be all and end all of how we judge it or anything, but like, you're talking it up, but would you use it?
I mean, if I was to use a completely free distro, this would probably be the one I go for.
That's fair. Yeah, no, given that, then fair enough. Yep. Yeah.
But it is also, is it a corporate distro? Because it's for computers. A particular. I'm just going to check to see if it's not like a company backed OS. A fully convergent, user-friendly, secure for daily use.
Oh, it's Purism thing. Oh, I didn't realize that.
Purism, that's it.
Well, Purism are a social purpose corporation, not a for-profit. I mean, you can argue about the distinctions, but that's at least a little bit better.
They use their own bug tracker. They use their own wiki.
I mean, the social purpose corporation, they do still run for a profit, I think. They just take into consideration social good as well.
Yeah. I don't know. So like, it's basically, what degree is it riding on the Debian coattails? Like, a fair bit. But then to what degree?
I mean, is it just Debian? Like, could you replicate? Could you get exactly what you'd have with Pure OS by using Debian and selecting certain packages? Or
You could at the very least get 99% of the way there.
Yeah. I mean, why do you need that then? That's kind of my argument against
yeah,
it.
Yeah, but is it so?
It seems to be the kind of distro you just use to say that you use it, to go like, I'm fucking freer than you and therefore better than you. When you could achieve exactly the same thing by using Debian.
It's a distro of principles, that's for sure.
So if Debian's not principled enough.
No, but this isn't like, is it like, but so Debian's great. Are we going to knock points off of it because of basically something based on Debian isn't quite free enough? It's a bit old. It's based on Debian, but it's a bit old, I think. It gets a bit old. That's quite bad because Debian stable, like, as much as I love slow and steady, like, my C, as we recently worked out, my C++ library is, you know, is out of date.
You're all over this one, aren't you?
I kind of am, because it's like, it's, you know, if I'm torn between, like, I don't know,
to me it's pointless. That's my, fundamentally, I just see it as a pointless endeavor.
I mean, anything B and below is pointless.
Oh, poor Seuss.
Sorry. Well, I mean, you know, we can't. I think it's a B because they're trying to push their own frontier. I appreciate
for a for-profit corporation.
I appreciate a little bit of dogmatism. A little bit of dogmaticness.
Fine. I think we should move on.
Okay.
One.
All right. Is there anything down the bottom here? Is that the peppermint logo? Or
I don't know what that logo is. I think it might be. It looks a little. I don't know what that is, honestly. I think we should.
What's that one? The purple. Can't read.
Endeavor. This one is this an Endeavor OS?
Endeavor. It's another one of those ones that I don't care about, I think. What's Endeavor's? I've heard about
Arch,
it. Up, forgot.
Arch with polish.
Who cares? I think that is the one that gets recommended currently. I think it is. I think that I've not used it, so take this with a pinch of whatever, but it seems to be Monjaro done correctly.
Yes.
So
I'll stick it in B.
I'll defer to you on that one because I've not used it and not particularly familiar with it.
I'll put it in B. Like, Arch is pretty good and easy to install and whatever, but if you want Arch but with a little bit more, okay, what about Slack? This is the Slackware logo, isn't it?
It is, yeah. For me, Slackware is the people who are scared of Arch. Slackware is what they think Arch is. It's everything is completely manual. Like, I think even last time I used it didn't even have automatic dependency resolution. You had to manually install the dependencies before you installed a package. For me, nothing is doing what what Slackware does. It was the daddy of all the other distros, really, you know, other than the one I forget the name of. What is it? The tree one. If there was a tier above S, I would put Slackware there.
Oh, okay. So you think it's okay. I was really wondering where you were going to go with that.
And I have used it for periods, and I do eventually get tired of the manualness, but it is love. While you're enjoying it, it's fucking amazing. It's lovely. It's
so for the people plus, it's plus. For.
Yeah.
But hang on a minute. Yeah. Hang on a minute. Whilst I totally agree with a lot of what you said there, you did say if you're not, like, what was the criteria for S? If you couldn't, like.
Yeah, I would be happy to switch over to Slackware and use it as my distro.
Okay. I'm like...
I've actually toyed with the idea quite frequently, yeah. I like Slackware a lot.
Well, I've had that similar idea with Gen 2.
Yeah, Gen 2. I think basically everything I said about Gen 2, other than, you know, it being the daddy of them all, I think Gen 2, yeah, same.
Utterly
configurable. You can compile everything from source. It's got a kind of automated way of doing that. There's nothing like it.
I've never used Gen 2, but again, from time to time, I think, what about a virtual machine or something just to like put the training wheels on? Maybe I should do. Maybe that would be a good one for the group in Discord, isn't it? Like, let's together try and install Gen 2.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, if Slackware is what people are afraid of Arch Linux think Arch Linux is, Gen 2 is what Linux enthusiasts. Arch enthusiast think Arch is, because the new Arch enthusiast thinks Arch is like so slimmed down and like gives you all this power and I get so much more performance, none of which is true. In most benchmarks, Ubuntu does better. But Gen 2 is that you can tune. Yeah, you can tune the shit out of everything in Gen 2.
I thought Arch was
Arch actually doesn't perform particularly well.
Oh, okay. I mean, I'll have to take your word for that. There was a time where I'm sure that I was like in a Linux crossroads where I was thinking Arch on one hand and Gen 2 on the other. And I went with Arch. And I was like, what would my life be like if I went the other route?
I mean, Gen 2 is a lot of work. If you're somebody who toys with things a lot and, you know, installs and removes packages a lot, you're going to be spending a lot of time doing that. If you're somebody who just, you know the tools you want, you just leave them installed, kind of like Debian. You just leave them on there and you want, you know, you want that tuning. Gen 2 is great.
Yeah. Okay. We're running out of ones that I know what they are. I bet there are people like, feel free to correct us in the comments if we get any of these logos wrong, but I'm trying to check.
I think it's Zorin, isn't it?
Zorin. I don't know Zorin very well.
I don't know anything about it. I've got things to say about Void. That's the only one left that I think I've got anything to say about.
Okay, what do you have to say about Void? Because I don't know much about Void.
Void is one of those, it's from scratch, I think. Mm-hmm. And I think it wants to be Arch without systemd.
Okay.
And I found that an intriguing idea. I'm ambivalent towards systemd. I think it's a useful tool. I think some of the criticisms against it are nonsense. But I, you know, I like the idea of things being a bit more old-fashioned with just, you know, text-based init files and everything. So I was intrigued and I installed it and it was a fucking nightmare. I did not. There's people who love it. I know it's got a lot of people who are big fans of it over Arch. I did not have a good time with it. It was fragile. It broke a lot. It was difficult to fix. Things were stepping over each other. And what one thing it did do is sort of, it really opened my eyes to how good really systemd is. Because you go back to how Linux was. Essentially, it's going back to how Linux was before systemd. And it's like it's slow booting because systemd is really good at parallelizing things. It's finicky, you know, if you want to start this thing before that thing, do you remember how difficult that was before systemd came along and make sure that, you know, it's not a race condition, you know, this is always going to start before that thing, you have to put a sleep 10 in it and stuff like that. Yeah. Yeah, no, Void is a reminder of why systemd is really good. So I sort of respect what it was going for, but personally had no fun using it whatsoever. So oh, but I don't want to put it lower than fucking Fedora, though, for fuck's sake. We've got two B's too stacked.
Do you want to split B into... B is like an average in a way, isn't it?
B's like...
I mean, B is an average, right?
Maybe Endeavor should be an A then, because Endeavor is better than anything else in B, I think.
Okay. What about Centos or?
I mean, again, it's I don't really care. Not for me.
Okay. What about Raspbian Pi?
I mean, that's just Debian on Raspberry Pi. I use it. I use it on a couple of my Raspberry Pis, but it's just Debian.
S tier then?
Well, kind of, but it's just Debian with a Raspberry. Like, it's not. They don't do anything.
You're saying Debian, but with a Raspberry, like it's a bad thing.
Well, I'm saying it's
no notes.
It's like, I know, what's the greatest novel? Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, right? And if I say, you know, okay, mark Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, and then mark a photocopy of Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment where I've changed the cover.
Mm-hmm.
Like, is that the same mark as Dostoevsky because it's the same thing? Or is it like, well, that's just a copy of this, so I don't know.
It's written by the same guy. It's the
yeah, but to me, the mark for Raspbian is encompassed in the mark for Debian. I don't feel comfortable giving Raspbian an S because out of distros you can run on the Raspberry Pi, it's awful, honestly. Yeah, Arch is better on a Raspberry Pi, honestly.
Does that put it down to an A then?
Yeah.
Which is still a solid tier. What's this one? This Ruda. Is this Peruda? This is cutting some letters.
Beruda or something? What is it?
Beruda.
What if I just put... The snowflake one is familiar, and also the one that's cut... is that Sabayon? No, it's not Sabayon. What's the one with the sort of like dragony? I recognize that one.
I don't know that one.
I don't know the uncomfortable zoom on Tux's face. I'm not sure what that one is.
Is that Damn Small Linux?
Maybe. That's pretty cool again, but...
Should we just assume this is Damn Small Linux?
Let's pretend it is. And I mean, it's very similar to MX, right? Similar kind of thing, similar thing they're going for.
Cool. Yeah.
But if you want to run Linux in like 1 meg, then that's your boy.
I think they've stretched it out a little bit now. I think they've got different versions, but they've got like a version that's like, this will actually run on modern stuff. So
that was the one that, at least it's an Inception, you could run it off a floppy, right? I remember actually doing that.
Something like that. I mean, it was 50 megabytes for the longest time.
I remember that whichever one it was that you could put on a floppy, I was kind of amazed. It was like, you basically got everything I've got on my desktop on a floppy. How'd you do that?
It's not Garuda. What about, what's vanilla? No, that's not vanilla. Not Anti-X, no. What's this one? This one is Arco Linux. That's a strange one to include in there. 44 on
that's on the one. Distro, that's the one I was saying. I think it's just Arch with an install script, isn't it?
Previously known as Arch Merge, is a distribution based on Arch, development in 3 branches, full feature distribution shipped with XFCE, minimal distribution includes scripts that enable power users to install any desktop application.
For me, that's just, what we're marking there is a bunch of bash scripts. I don't care.
Is that never tried, or is that...
It's Arch. Once it's installed, it's Arch. I never tried, not interested. Like, okay. Cool that it exists, I'm not pissing on it, but it's not a distro, really. It's a tool for installing a different distro. Yeah. The Dragon one is Kali.
Oh, well, that's at least an A, isn't it?
That's an A because it's a specialized, nothing else does what it does. It's very specialized and it's very good for doing what you do with it if you need to do that, right?
And it runs on, it's on Mr. Robot.
It's on Mr. Robot and it got a bunch of people to install it as a desktop operating system.
But he also uses Mint.
Oh, does he really?
He uses Mint as his daily driver and uses
I thought it was all Kali.
Tally on the, yeah.
Trying to look what the snowflake he was one is.
The thing about Mr. Robot that's also cool is that the guy Elliot, I think he's is he called Elliot? The
something like that. I don't think it's called that, but it's something like that.
Yeah, he's Rami Malek. He has his tower back to front, so that you've got all the plugs on the front. He's one of those people.
Oh, really?
Yeah. The little details, and also the corporate guy. I don't know what distribution he runs, but there's a little bit. There's the scenes where he's in like in the cabin in the woods. He runs XFCE, but he does not make any changes to it. It's like Debian version of XFCE. Like it's just XFCE straight out of the box. Is raw dog in XFCED, and it's because I don't know. Is that to go with his lumberjacking ways? He's out there chopping wood and then using XFCE without adding a theme. It's just like.
Well, they have an argument, not an argument, don't they? But there's a conversation in episode one where they're arguing against GNOME versus KDE, basically, which is a conversation that would never happen, but it's funny. I can't find the Snowflake one.
I don't know. Like it's a nod and a wink, isn't it? But the there's one where he goes into I think it's like an underground rave or something, and the volume of the show goes down to indicate he's like zoning out. And they've got the little icon of like the, so if you press volume down in GNOME, it puts a little icon in the center. I was running GNOME at the time, and I thought I like sat on my volume thing or something.
And it's like, that's funny.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's just like, it's just a weird coincidence that it just uses the GNOME like effect. And I thought, because the chances of it, it just feels just so unlikely to me. Like if it happened now, because I'm on XFCE, I would have probably clocked that it would have been on the telly.
That's why I've always said, if I ever make a movie, it's going to be a bit in the middle where you get like a buffering circle, and then everybody watching it online is going to be fucking.
I'm just trying to look. Catchy OS is 9. No, that's not it. What's the snowflake looking one?
I'm trying to find that. I can't. I recognize it. I've seen it, but I can't recall it. I'm googling it. I can't find
it. Not Alma Linux. Is it Rocky Linux? Oh, there's one called Blue Star, but I don't know. That doesn't sound like it. It looks like I've seen it before. No, it's not Blue Star. This isn't Probola, is it?
Isn't what, sorry?
This isn't Parabola, is it?
Parabola.
Parabola.
Yeah,
no.
If it isn't. No, because that would end in an A, not an AR, right?
Is it is that Baruda?
Yeah, there's one called Garuda or Baruda or.
That's it, yeah.
I mean, worth saying, like, you and I have probably used. Especially because, you know, we lived through the era of distro hopping because no Linux distro really was quite perfect for a very long time. We've all used a lot of Linux distros, but yeah, I haven't used any of those at the bottom or the never tried or I never used whatever that is on D. I can't remember.
Neon Linux.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Garuda Linux is based on Arch.
Well, to be fair, out of S2C, I think the only ones I haven't used are Endeavor and Pure. I think I've used every other one.
I've not used Red Hat. I've not used Void. I've not used Gentoo, Slackware. What's this one again? The
That's Kali.
Oh, I spun Kali up, but I've not.
Yeah.
Not done.
Never, I've never used it, but yeah, I've spun it up and had a look at it.
Yeah, I don't know if I think I might have had a very brief liaison with CentOS, but
I've never used CentOS. Yeah,
but we've almost certainly played on CentOS servers and so forth.
I don't think I've used MX.
Oh yeah, no. But MX is. What about Rocky Linux? Is that? I don't know. I don't. No, it's not Rocky Linux. Oh. It's not chaos. No. Okay. Is there like a Linux logo guide or something.
I've looked. I can't find that one. I've seen it in places. I think I've seen it in probably one of the fetches. I've probably seen it amongst its logos and gone, oh, that's that one. Actually, that might be a way to find out. Let's have a look at the fetch.
I'm going to do a reverse Google image search.
Oh, that's a good idea. I never think of that.
Oh, it's great for detective work.
Yeah.
Right, so I'm going to... Yeah. I'm gonna drag that over here, I think, I hope. I think. Do I have to do it? Do I have to save the image or something?
Yeah, you have to be able to drag it in. I think you can do it just by... You can drag it from some places.
Yeah, let's see. Oh, NixOS.
Oh, of course it's Nix. I've used NixOS. I think, okay, for me, so NixOS is another one that's doing things that no other thingy is doing. It has that, I forget what they call it. The way it installs packages, it's you sort of write a config file that then installs all your packages for you, and it's very clever. I think you can run it immutable, or either it does, or you can run it immutable. I have installed it and I've used it, and it was a bit too complicated for me, but I very much respect it, and I think it's doing some very clever stuff. So it's either S or A for me, and I'd say S. But
okay, if you think.
I think okay. NixOS is very cool and very clever.
Okay, and also, so if I open image in new tab, I can actually see LFS. Okay.
Oh.
I don't know.
Like Linux from scratch. Have you ever done a Linux from scratch?
Gosh, no. Is that like Gentoo?
It is literally Linux with no distro. So you download everything individually and compile it, and then move on from there. So the first thing you have to get is a kernel, I guess, and then you move, and then you compile your kernel. You do it step by step. I think there's a sort of base that you start with. So it's kind of like it's DIY Gentoo. It's not really. I think there are some people who run it.
I thought Gentoo was DIY Gentoo.
Because Gentoo is relatively easy. Yeah, you can fit you. Anyway, what's Portage? Yeah, Gentoo uses Portage, which sort of handles all the complicated stuff for you. Yeah, so LFS is not, it's a project that you do to learn about Linux rather than something that you're intended to run long term, because obviously updating that is a fucking nightmare. I think there are some nutbags who run it full time, but. It's not really intended.
Let
for
us
that.
Know in the comment section of the PeerTube, because you're not going to be on YouTube if you're doing that.
That's fucking true. I've never done it.
How would you rate it then? Is it still on A? It feels like A's.
I mean, it's not a distro. I don't see how we compare it to. It's just downloading things and then compiling and installing them. It's a learning process, is what. Yeah, I think never tried would be fair. I don't see how we rank it next to our distros.
And also, anyone who's like, well, I mean, there's going to be a lot of disagreement, I'm sure, on this. So definitely, like, put in your own tier list in the comments. Actually, PeerTube's really good at long comments, but I think YouTube's not too bad at that now. All right. So, but yeah, we look forward to it. I was going to say, if there are any of the never tried, like, definitely, like, let us know, like, what your takes are on them, because. Okay, deep in. That's what this one is. The deep in.
Is that Chinese one?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, never tried.
I've tried it. I think it was fine. Is it based on Debian? I think.
Look.
Let's see. Deep in. I think I give it a go.
It is that Chinese one.
It's quite popular on DistroWatch. Based on.
It is corporate, Debian. So it can't be an S.
I mean, honestly, I think it has to go in the never tried, don't know category.
Yeah, I don't know enough about it. And we've missed off Red Star Linux, which is the North Korean. Juche Linux.
Nobara, this is.
Oh, yeah, heard of that. Know nothing about it.
No bar.
Oh, actually, is that one of the ones? Because there's a couple of distros. I think Endeavor is one of them that gamers are recommending lately. Yeah, I think Endeavor's one. I think No Bar might be the other one. Is it like Fedora, but
with NVIDIA drivers. Yeah. Looks nice. Last update this year.
Based on Fedora. It's developed by blah blah. Oh, it's Glorious Eggroll's distro.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. So it's Fedora. It's Fedora, but games. So, given that it's Glorious Eggroll's distro, let's put it on S.
Yeah, let's put it on S.
We don't do nepotism.
No. We'll put it on S. And actually, I just want to say, looking at the DistroWatch logo, it's a nicer logo on that we give it credit for. Like,
yeah.
I'll pop up the logo.
Fedora. I think Fedora is a good base to do something good with.
Yes, I get that vibe. It's modern.
I see the sense of that. It's up to date without being odd, essentially.
But yeah, no,
that is a cute little penguin.
Oh yeah, I didn't see the penguin. Yeah, I thought that was just a cool N. No, there's a penguin in the N. And also,
are you happy with that S tiers?
I think so, because also, like, nepotism aside, Glorious Eggroll has contributed so much to Linux gaming.
Yeah.
Isn't there a Proton version? Like Eggroll's Proton, isn't that?
Ozone tells stories about Ozone was working for Red Hat, and Ozone was looking at what Eggroll was doing and saying, "You should work for Red Hat. Let me get you a job at Red Hat." And Glorious Eggroll's going, "Oh no, I'm not clever enough to work at Red Hat." Ozone's going, "You're writing your own fucking version of Proton and doing all this." Of course, you're clever. So you see, like, it's quite humble, I guess, as well. Yeah.
I think the, you know, like, yeah, certainly a stalwart of the community. We've got a lot to be grateful for from Eggroll. So, totally an S tier. I mean, in reality, we're really putting Eggroll himself as an S tier person, really. And I think, to be honest, because Fedora's quite up to date. I've dropped out. Okay, was my thing always like this? Hang on a minute.
Like what?
Did it have extra bits on the top and bottom? I thought I cropped all that out.
I mean, I can only see the Discord stream.
Oh well, it doesn't matter. It looks fine.
Okay, so say I deleted Debian and Mint from that list. What would you use
from all of this?
Yeah, out of all of these, I delete Debian and Mint because I think they would be your go-tos. What would you use? What's your next choice?
Arch.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Because, like, I mean, Slackware, Gentoo. Oh, actually, I mean, might give Glorious Eggroll's Nabara a go.
The only thing that puts me off is the Fedora base, honestly, because, again, corporate, blah, blah, blah. But, I mean, he works for Red Hat. Well, he used to. I don't know if he still works for Red Hat, but he did at some point work for Red Hat, so... I think for me, my next choice, if I couldn't use Arch, it would either be Debian or Slackware, depending on which direction I wanted to go.
Yeah, I like MX. MX would be a go-to.
We got some good distros. We're very lucky,
maybe
boys and girls.
Endeavor. And days.
Yeah, Endeavor looks kind of cool. I mean, that's Arch, really, but yeah.
Yeah, it's Arch, isn't it? I think at this stage in my Linux life, I can go straight to the source.
Yeah.
It's fine. And I appreciate it because I like knowing how... Like, I prefer to know how things work under the hood. Like, I'm not super obsessive about it, but it's one of the reasons that I like, playing around with, like, ISWM and stuff like that, because it's just kind of... You know exactly what you're getting.
Yeah.
So,
all right. I think, are we done?
I think we're done.
Hugely,
I mean, this...
we had some agreements, but it wasn't hugely controversial.
I'm sure. Oh, absolutely. But let's see what everyone thinks. This is like coming up to a 3.5 hour video.
Yeah, we should stop there for the better. Our audience, they must be fucking exhausted.
Absolutely. Let us know if you've done this in parts.
If you've made it this far, you win a free t-shirt that you have to buy and design yourself. Get a blank t-shirt, draw something on it.
Actually, we did talk about that in the Discord, isn't it? Like, like far too many YouTubers sort of fall into the fast fashion thing where there are so many better alternatives than just selling fucking t-shirts. Half the time,
do you know what? Yeah. If you got this far and you would like to, go to a charity shop, get a nice item of clothing, take a picture of it, and show us.
Yeah, actually, totally. Actually, this is this came really from a charity shop.
And that's also a lovely cardigan. That looks so fucking cozy.
It's almost too warm.
You have a flower shirt as well.
Yeah, the flower shirt, all this stuff. The thing is, first-hand stuff, unless you're paying, you know, hundreds of pounds, it just doesn't last.
It's shitty quality, yeah.
Yeah, and so I'm just like, you know, it's nice and warm. This is really around the house kind of thing. But to be honest, kind of like the style. These days I'm feeling a bit like, I don't say like jaded with the world, but like a little bit like, I don't know, burnt. But I feel like a burnout. And I kind of like, not in a bad way, not in a negative way. It's just like, you know, I feel like, it's just like, you know.
It looks very comfortable and very cozy.
It's very comfortable, but I like giving less of a shit about society's expectations.
You
know, and
I'm certainly on board with that.
Not in a fuck you kind of way. Like I like being nice to people, but you know, loving yourself and your community is honestly, it's one of the most radical acts in the face of, you know, stamp on your neighbor capitalism that we live in. You know, and they're trying to make us. You know, one of the things, I don't want to sound like a pearl clutching liberal when I say this, but like misinformation is so fucking wild at the moment with the US election cycle, like and you know, we are being pitted against each other like never before, right? And and I say this just after doing a fucking tier list that inflames a flame war,
but about something that really doesn't matter, so it's fine.
Yeah, but it's like I'm so fucking sick of capitalism pitting us against each other. Like it's just fucking gross. I don't want to stop fighting. I want to stop, you know. I'm you know, it's just, we don't have to.
Yeah, that's a nice message, yeah.
That's what we'll take away with us.
That's what we learned.
But yeah, I mean, because the thing is as well, like capitalism loves making you feel shit about yourself, isn't it?
Because then you need to buy things to feel better about yourself.
Yeah, you're too fat, so either have a cookie or have some weight loss drugs.
You buy things to make yourself feel better about yourself and make yourself feel like you're better than other people.
You're not a man if you don't drive a big fucking car. It's bullshit. They're manipulating us. And it's not even good bullshit. It's easy to see through. It's
stupid,
just
stupid bullshit.
Stupid bullshit. So, you know.
Don't do what they say. Do what you want.
Yeah.
Maybe nice. You know,
and also, your job isn't who you are.
No, God, fuck no.
No, don't be one of those people.
You can only talk about their work.
So, thank you very much for watching. Let us know if you do make it to the end. It's probably
that's
just
a weird ending. That was like a Sesame Street ending.
Yeah, so I haven't actually finished recording yet, but
Thank you for watching this one, guys.
Thank you for watching, and good night, and
may the universe bless you.
Yeah, that's it. something. Imagine that we said different. Something. Yeah, imagine that we said something like Carl Sagan-y. You know, like that's.
That's your homework.
Yeah. Toodaloo.